everybody. We're going to do a little paper pass out here and then we'll get started. So, you're getting us rolling tonight. I'm looking for approval of minutes from the March 11th, the April 15th, and the May 13th meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Any comments on
yes.
that?
Yes. On the committee, on the 13th,
okay.
The committee for the DPW director, it's Devine and Keegan, not Chunglo and Keegan. On DPW search committee, under number two select board members, it says Chunglo and Keegan. That was me, right, Joycey?
Yeah.
That
wasn't
me, right? Okay.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other changes? So all those in favor with the amendment?
Aye.
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 Aye. I abstain from 13.
I'm going to abstain from the 11th. I wasn't elected at that point.
All right. So looking for approval of warrant number 93.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Did you have to do approval? You took a... Did you do aye after he said...
I said amended.
Amended.
All right, so let's jump down and do some little things quickly. So Maureen Porter has been recommended to appointment to the Cultural Council.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Thank her very much for coming out and applying for the position. I'm sure they'll be very happy to have her.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, Texas Roadhouse.
I actually have a question on that. When we appointed to the library committee, I was told that they had to be here for that as well.
Not for
Culture Council, because it's non-elected appointment.
Correct.
Thank you. Appreciate that clarification.
We have a letter also from Susan Norris on the Hadley Culture Council, and they unanimously voted to recommend her.
Here she is.
Right in.
Hello.
Congratulations.
Oh, did she disappoint?
We did.
Do you want to hear anything more about her, or do you?
Love to.
No?
Do you want your
mom? Yeah, I'd love to.
Oh, you would.
Sounds like a wonderful candidate.
Yeah, she really is. She's been here only 5 years in Hadley. She was on the Amherst School Committee for many years, and then taught and was an administrator at Hampshire Regional. Now she teaches at UMass. And she'd be really honored to be on the council, and we would really recommend her.
She was unanimously appointed. Thank you for your recommendation.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Right.
Are there any vacancies at this point in time on the council?
We're always looking for new members. There could be more, but we're fine. We have seven now.
Excellent.
And Debbie Wendelowski has moved to Hatfield, so I think her term is up in about a month, so she probably will not return.
So Texas Roadhouse, they have a change in manager of their existing liquor license in their non-existent building.
Right, so they're one of the special legislation licenses. They've just been holding on to it. You know, we hope that they start their construction. They had, John Prescott that they had put for the manager before, and now they're replacing him with a Nathaniel Journey. So all the paperwork's in, and once you guys approve it, it'll be sent to the ABCC, who will be recording all the stuff.
Was there any comments from the police chief?
He had no issues with that.
In that we don't have a building, how is there a manager? Is this a someone from corporate or something?
No, they had placed a manager last
They placed
last
a manager.
Time
this guy's actually from Kentucky, so they must be moving him from another location. But when you put it on the license, you need to have the name of a manager who would be overseeing the license, because they need to have a manager on the site.
The last manager was also the building construction and fit out. He was doing the whole thing,
yeah.
So,
okay.
Tim, is there anything on the horizon with them starting?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of holdup because of the natural gas issue. And they're one of the ones that have to come in, and they should be coming shortly to you with regard to the land permit for the new propane tank. So it's got, I mean, there's a whole new gamut. It's just trying to get everything worked out. You guys have one or two?
We received one from American River Nutritional.
So thanks. Now we got the system worked. It should be forthcoming. It's been a nightmare, to say the least.
Yeah, I'm spending a couple.
And we're going to have more nightmares.
I'm spending a couple $1,000 to put in a propane tank because they told me my generator was bigger than the other one and I couldn't keep my gas service. So it's really kind of, it's hurting a lot of people and it's unexpected. So, you know, when you think you can keep your gas service, you're losing your gas service.
And with people that have signed contracts with Berkshire Gas in there, they don't care.
Yeah.
No gas, can't serve you.
Okay, so do we have a motion to?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We've done our political commentary for the night. All right, top of the campus wants a one-day liquor license for June 16th for a formal reception and dinner for the Board of Trustees at their new field house.
So moved.
Second.
Was everything in order for?
Everything's in order. The UMass campus police handle anything. Chief Mason said they've never had any issue with events held there. So, everything's good to go.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Can I ask a question relative to the process here? Is there any way for us to not have to vote on every single one of these? I mean, I understand we're the licensing authority, but is there a way to streamline it and have like some sort of sign-off or something so that
I think
do we actually, like by law, we have to have each one of these?
No, it's done differently in different towns. In many towns, the select board are the local licensing authority, and other towns, the select board sets up a special licensing body, a commission or an authority of some kind. And they handle all the licenses.
So it's something we could look at if we wanted to.
We have to do a special
I kind of at this point would like to know what's coming and where the licenses are going. I would like to be aware of that too.
But that's reporting.
I know.
Having it reported.
But still, if they're reporting, we might as well vote on it. And we did that kind of with a license, our license, and we ran into a little snafu there that one time, and I just assumed.
So there are issues of what do you want for the community. If you have a license application where there has been a problem or if there's been a history and they're up for renewal, you have the authority as select board members to not reissue that license. Mm-hmm. Or you may decide that you have enough liquor in town and that even though you may have licenses still available under the quota, you may decide that because of the health of the community would be enhanced by having more diversity in those businesses, you may not issue the license. So if you're going to transfer that authority to some other agency, it's a pretty hefty bit of your authority that has to do with both enforcement as well as community development.
Mm-hmm. But other towns do it.
Other towns do it. Mm-hmm.
Just as a matter of procedure, if we ever do have one that comes here and there's a problem with the police chief, I would like to have the people invited to the meeting. Mm-hmm. Or else,
we've had that before.
Let's make
sure
that
they're for it and, yeah.
Make sure they're invited to the meeting if we anticipate the police chief is not in favor of it, so we don't delay it and we can address it at that evening.
I think we've all, we haven't had one, it's not been an issue for a while. Okay, so now it's time to get into our little,
don't you have a requisition for that? For shelves for payment, received a transmittal from Ty and Don for pay requisition number 10, and it says, number 10 for pump station number 1 and number 4 upgrades. The items requested for payment in this requisition include installation of conduits and wiring between the motor control center and the 3 Gorman Rupp pumps, installation of the removable handrails and access staircase, partial payment for the fire suppression system components, and completion of the chain, hoist, and trolley system within the control building at pump station number 1 during the month of April of 2015. Please have payment endorsed by the Board of Selectmen. Do you have a copy of this, David?
No, this is it.
This just came in the last 2 days, is why it's not on the agenda if you're looking for it.
Right. It just came in today.
And did you have a chance to review
it?
Yes, I did. Comfortable with the payment being made?
Yeah. Tom Kuchar about it, Charlie Tripp.
So any other questions about it?
And this is concerning pump station number 4, too?
One.
No. It's a payment.
It's a payment.
You said 1 and 4?
Yes.
So it's just a progress payment. We still have a hold back on that?
Yes, we're taking 5%.
5%.
Any other questions about it?
I have a question about the change order, but not that.
You want to see it?
Oh, yeah.
So the change order we're going to talk about at our meeting on the next meeting.
Mm-hmm. Not this year?
No.
The third.
Just like to add that we're looking at alternative ways of doing that project. That's probably one of the reasons why Ty and Bond, Tom Kuchar, requested that we talk about this at our next meeting.
Yeah, I just
want to update. That was part of the regular bid.
Okay, so is there a motion on the change order?
It's not
I mean,
not
change order, on the payment. Payment number two.
To accept the payment.
A second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I think I'm thinking of a change order.
So we'll have more information when we talk about it again.
Okay, so now for our, this meeting was really, we weren't supposed to do much business. We were supposed to have a lot of discussion and visioning and talk like this. So I'm gonna kick it off with talking about our most favorite item going on right now is our buildings. So we have a building committee here to give us an update of where we are and where we're going next with the buildings. So where we think they should, we should go next.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. I did hand out a list of items I wanted to discuss tonight, and the general housekeeping items were just simply the select board should have in front of them a letter from our selection panel recommending a project consultant architectural engineering firm to engage as an on-call consultant. We've completed the interview process and made a unanimous recommendation to select the firm that's listed on the letter. In front of you, there's copies of the final proposals from each of the consultants. If you'd like to look at them, you may have looked at them already. So as the select board, I think it's your purview to make a final approval of the recommendation, right? That's the
right. So a little bit nuanced. We received the recommendation from the Municipal Building Committee, which was given the task of evaluating and ranking the proposed on-call architects. We've received their proposal, and now the next part of the procurement process would be to negotiate a price with the number one ranked architect, and if you can achieve an agreement on that price, then you've got a deal.
David, my understanding though is that there's not actually a task order assigned yet, so there's nothing really to negotiate.
It'd be a price per hour, something like that.
So certified payroll, in other words, salaries for individuals. Okay. I've not seen it done that way, but that's your procurement process then.
Is it usually task based?
I thought we set this up as being on call services, so it would be task based.
Mm-hmm.
If you hired an electrician, you'd pay a price per hour, right? Wouldn't these firms have a price per hour for technicians versus different levels that you would need? And here's my point where I'm heading to. I mean, if all of a sudden that this was, I mean, we can get painting done. You can hire Picasso and you can hire Billy. Sometimes you can pay Picasso and then there's no money left over for anything else. And sometimes you need Billy. I've sat in on those interviews. They absolutely were the number one choice of everybody there. But if we find out subsequent to this that their price per hour isn't competitive or isn't something that's we feel is price effective, do we not have an, wouldn't we go back at that point in time and say to the building committee, you know, we found the number to be, you know, $375 an hour for engineering. Do you feel that's appropriate, or do you feel that would eat up the $50,000 that we have allocated for this task ahead of us?
But usually this is professional services. So we choose the group we think is the best. And then when we go for a task order, they give us a task order, and that's when we negotiate the price. And we say, no, we think that's too much.
Then you negotiate.
That would be the negotiation point.
But I believe per the Brooks Act, which describes the whole process for engineering and architectural services, that you're only allowed to procure a consultant based on qualifications. That money cannot be part of your decision to hire a consultant. I believe that's the case.
That's how you're supposed to get the listing, yes.
If there's any state money involved, that would be the case. I'm not sure about county monies and how that works. Maybe we need to clarify that, David, before we proceed with a formal recommendation.
Well, I think we're right. I think we're right in accepting them as number one and entering into an agreement. I believe that is what we would do next. And then we would negotiate with the task orders and tell them, and we may negotiate them right out and drop them and enter into the next group after the first task order. But I think you accept their proposal and you enter into an agreement with them first.
I have, you know, as a consultant myself, I have 3 on calls currently. And generally, I don't get a contract until I sign that first task order. You know, there's no money, there's no fee involved until there's a scope, and I'll scope and negotiate a fee with my client. And then at that time, the entire boilerplate contract document is brought to me, and the insurance requirements, all that. And I turn that in, and there's a contract between my client and the consultant.
Do you have any municipal clients?
I have state clients and agencies. I do not have a municipal client, so it's different in that respect.
Quasi-government stuff.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
So do you're looking like you disagree with this conversation?
We said in the RFQ that we would negotiate a price. So if you'd like to do that based upon the task, you can do that.
And within the scope of the RFQ?
Yeah.
Not be in conflict with the RFQ?
Right.
It seems to logically make sense that that's what we would do.
And what do we have in there for monies? For
$50,000.
Well, that depends on the results of next week's bidding.
Right, we've used some monies from the asbestos engineering procurement document, so there's $17,000 less in the $50,000 starter fund for the project consultant.
Unless the bids come in either so low that we can pay for the
right.
asbestos
engineering
design
that, bid.
Or if the bids come in so high, we're not going to be, you know, so okay. You've got a little bit of...
Somewhere between 33 and 50.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So really where we are now is if we want to, because there actually isn't a contract to sign, they give us a contract to sign, did they?
No.
So where we are now is to approve the building committee's first choice, and then continue, go forward and say, okay, I don't think we'd actually, then we need to talk about what we're going to do next with this group.
Yes.
And then pull in the contract.
So I'll make a motion to accept the recommendation of the municipal building committee to enter into a conversation with Lindgren and Sharples.
Second.
Just for clarification, it's the recommendation of the selection panel.
I'm sorry.
Which is slightly
selection
different.
Panel
right.
of the mm-hmm. municipal building. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And the board really.
And just to stay one more time, how many proposals did we get?
We shortlisted, or we got 3. We interviewed 3.
Okay. Just so everybody knows, we did get responses, and this isn't the only one. Okay, so any other questions, comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to the committee.
My next topic was to recommend some coordination with finance and with other persons that are responsible for putting budgets in following town meeting results. There's been some, not disparities, but maybe some confusion on our part about how monies, after they're approved by this by the town meeting, how they're put into the budgets and what we can do with them afterwards. So I'm going to let Andy take it from here, but I think that it's just some communication we need to improve.
So yes, thank you. Part of what we're, the discussions we want to talk with the Finance Committee includes these things of how the warrant article monies get allocated. We had put together some in the fall, which had, you know, top level numbers that were supported by estimates below that. And what has manifested itself is some accounts that are highly narrow to each particular project that was listed out as a supporting number. What I mean is we don't have flexibility within that overall number to move money around. Let's say we're over on a project or under on another. That money is very tightly pigeonholed. We want to understand the process of how that occurred. And also some of the monies that we were looking at for accomplishing some of our other maintenance projects. It's been, let's say, challenging to say the least, to get a handle on where we are with the monies and how these accounts are being utilized. And we also found it difficult during the budgetary process, one of the questions from the select board, what is your building maintenance budget? Well, we're going in three or four different spots trying to mull it all up. And so we've had some discussions with people on the board and people in the finance committee as to whether or not we should look at readdressing the chart of accounts and see how we can pull them from different entities and start rolling them up. If this is going to be the direction that we want to go moving forward, what is the building maintenance budget? What are we spending here? Are there economies of scale that we could gather by combining them? If this is actually moving into that position that the town voted on a couple of years ago, building maintenance position, then that gives that person some budgetary clout. So anyway, without dragging that on too long, we'd like to continue this initiative to look at readdressing the chart of accounts and seeing how we can, hopefully if we establish that correctly, then we don't get ourselves caught in the situation that we just had this past fall, which is money is tightly pigeonholed and doesn't allow us to move it around. And also might aid in that whole $200,000 bit if we do start getting budget going forward.
I think that there are two issues tangled up in that. I believe that the chart of accounts is less problematic because assuming that these building maintenance line items have the same subcode within the accounting mask, Gail can run a report to say, give me all of the building maintenance across the town. So reporting on it, I don't think is that difficult. It's just a matter of working that out with Gail. But I think the real issue I'm hearing that you're raising is the governance, if you will, and responsibility for those line items rests with the cost center managers, whoever those department heads are. So we have this a dispersed authority over these line items.
Well, plus it's also closing the loop. If we have projects that are ongoing and we're depending on certain funding to be there for future, a list of projects, when we come back and the numbers are changing, it's hard to, without doing some forensics, to figure out where money's going and why.
So but that's because you may have five, making up whatever the number is, you could have five different individuals involved in the appropriation and expenditure of those line items. So you then are needing to go to each one of those department heads to figure out what's going on, right? I mean, that's the cumbersome nature of it.
That's one of the issues. The other issue is that, take for instance, under the public safety, the interior door, okay? We estimated 2,000. Now we get the bill at $2,066. We can only spend $2,000 on a line item. Where do we get the $66? So the question then is, after we get the to know that it's $2,066 to do the project, do we just drop it because it's 66 bucks? We just need some latitude to move money within the scope of that building on specifics, and we need to know how that would be the best way of dealing with that.
Well, I don't think the building committee personally would be moving the money.
No.
So
I just want to make sure that we can get to money to pay for what we want to do. If we have a slightly over, and if there's only $2,000, and that's all there is, and it's like this one, it's only $66 over. Luckily, we can pull it out of another line item, but it could actually mean that for a few pennies, we might not be doing a project. Want some way and figure out how we can, within a scope of a building or line, to pull a little bit back and forth so we can get some of these projects done.
Part of it is, yeah, we want to do the next project. How much money do we have left in the till? And if we're looking two or three projects down the road, and we come back and we get a big surprise, you know, that we have to, we find ourselves going back to town meeting, trying to, and the question will come up, where'd it go?
And then you get back to, they robbed the maintenance budget for something else in their department.
That's what we just had to do.
And it's been going on for years and years, and it really shouldn't be because of the condition of our buildings. You know, that money is put aside to maintain those departments and those buildings, those facilities.
So there's two things going on here, and for the future, we can resolve things going forward in the future. Mm-hmm. For some of the past stuff, though, we're kind of locked in to how we're set up. And
we understand that we want to avoid that stumble going forward.
Basically, that money that we asked for in October, we kind of came up with some prices for everything. We bundled it up, added it up, and we went to town meeting and asked for the money. The money was appropriated. We didn't know that everything that we budgeted was going to be in a separate account. You know, we didn't understand that. So now you go in, it's like, well, that's in that account. You can't, you know, you save $3,000 on the insulation, but you can't use it to finish the other window because it's, you know, pigeonholed. So we just want to make sure that as we're going forward, that doesn't happen again.
Okay.
It's the same with like the Russell School money, where, you know, that money we had originally thought it was going to be set aside for expenses to mothball the place and maybe some repairs. And it's now the money, I guess it's.
No, the money is set aside for Russell School.
Mm-hmm.
In capital stabilization, so we need to go back to town meeting to get
it. No, it's not capital
stabilization. Account for Russell School.
They do, actually.
We do.
We do have to go back for appropriation, but the money is in an account for the school.
So we have to wait until town meeting to get it.
I thought we just put it into like a capital revolving account.
Right, just remember it expires July 1.
Oh, it expires July 1.
But that was the intent, was to keep that intact.
Right. But we can't touch it until fall, and that creates a problem.
So you get into these lag times now where if we're, you know, trying to then wait till town meeting to get approval, and we've got to do expenditures shorter than that, especially on a building that we're going to be mothballing.
In anticipation of that particular building, we did increase the operational budget so that there's enough money to mothball the building after the tenant leaves. So we looked at it in terms of how can we protect some money, but also how can we free it somehow to be able to be used.
We're not entirely sure the cost of that yet, David, but we acknowledge that there is some money left there.
That should be
We just need to look into some HVAC and other security measures to protect that building for safety, mm-hmm. You know, when it's closed. So there's some thinking about what that entails.
So we just need to, and actually, when we wrote the articles for the capital projects, the way we voted them in town meeting, they were voted individually, but because they're all the same town meeting, is there any flexibility in how we wrote the articles that we can move them around within the articles because they're all capital?
I think that depends on how we phrased each article. In general, no. You know, if you put in $25,000 for this project and $30,000 for this project, you would need a town meeting vote to reapportion that money.
So we actually voted each one as its own article, is what you're saying,
but
not as a capital building article.
To include the following.
Because at this point in time in the projects that you've completed, you have about $6,000, you're under budget from what was projected to what was spent.
As a whole.
As a whole.
I mean, there's a lot of projects we haven't even gotten numbers on yet. So might be early
I'm
to
talking
say that,
completed.
But we're doing pretty well
yeah.
in terms of what we think it should cost and what we're actually paying.
So, Kosk, do you have any ideas on any other ways to do this in which can be accomplished the goal?
Well, I think that we have to go back to see exactly what was passed at town meeting and see what the language was.
Yeah, but if he
I know when we discussed all of them, there were specific numbers as to each building, but I don't know whether it was just voted on as a total or whether it was voted on as individual items.
I know, and committee's been in front of us a couple of times asking for X amount of dollars for building maintenance, and just so we don't run into a situation.
But this is very specifically projects that what came
no,
in under budget.
I understand, but in the
well,
future,
that's what they're looking for today.
I know, but further down the road here, we need to take that into consideration.
Exactly. We just need to be cautious about how we write
yeah.
the articles from now on.
Yeah, we need to write it. And somehow set up an accounting procedure that in whatever way it has to be done, if it's with buildings or with types of projects, just the way we can just play around. We have $3,000 left over on insulation in the DPW. We can't spend it on the two windows that we need to. You know, that's kind of a little frustrating. Now we have to go back to town meeting to say, oh, by the way, we got two windows we can't put in.
Well, no, you go back to town meeting and say, this is our leftover money, and we need to reappropriate these
yes,
projects.
Right.
That's what you're
it.
Saying.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's what you're saying.
Originally, we had, the town meeting warrant article was set up to say we have $400,000. That's not the exact number, but
there was a lump sum
and
money.
This was
and
the supporting information behind how we got to that number.
And we didn't
but what happened was it went from 400,000 broken into all those points.
And that's because we gave you all the details how we came up with the number, and that's how it got itemized in the ledger.
The wording of the motion is what's going to be driving how this money can be spent. So I'd be happy to sit down and go through the wording of each motion and see what is an itemized vote and which is a general pot of money. I know that we have, I want to say, about $150,000 for the senior center. We can use that for almost any project that we can dream up.
At the senior center.
We have $90,000 or so for the Russell School, which we can use for anything for the Russell School with the town meeting vote. So it depends on how it was written.
But with the senior center money, the other thing is we want to make sure that based on what we think needs to be done, that money isn't taken out of that line item, and then we find out we can't do the projects that we feel that should be accomplished at this point. And that to us is pretty serious.
And so I'm far less concerned about the monies that are left over from the projects than I am for the $66 that it throws one out. You know, we've allocated $2,000, we've itemized it, and now for $66, we're throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
Yeah, so
there needs to be.
You don't actually have to do that.
So you can negotiate with a low bidder. If you're close within $66, I'd be surprised that people wouldn't be willing to say, yeah, okay, I'll do it for the $2,000.
There's other ways of doing it, too. So,
yeah.
So we got your first issue, which is
yeah.
a good concern. So actually, while we're talking about this, how about tell us what your priorities are going forward so we have a little better idea how we want to line our money up.
Right. So this is going to be kind of a give and take, as I see it, about what we think about the buildings and the things we need to know and the positions we need clarified from you, the select board. It's slowly coming together, but there's a lot of things that we have to work together on our committee here. So getting into North Hadley Village Hall, as you know, the public info meeting was complete. We know what the results were. We know what the village preferences are in terms of end use of that building. We can roll that into an RFP per plan. So where we are in selling North Hadley Hall per the recommendation of the town meeting in the fall, we need the status of the preservation restrictions from the Historic Commission. I have emailed Ginger. I didn't get a reply back, but I only gave her a half a day. So there might be some progress there. Last I heard it was sometime in June that they would have those complete.
She's on, yeah, they said they've done a draft and it's been sent to the state for a review. They finished that review and there's one other thing going on.
There were some questions on the property lines. They were using the GIS mapping as opposed to the legal survey.
Okay.
It's not accurate. So, you know, we have two departments there. We need to talk about the timeline for moving the Park and Rec department. In my mind, it made sense to try and move everyone sooner rather than later so that we don't have any critical path items. And my thoughts were just simply to avoid another heating season as best we could, but that affects both Chief Spanknebel's operation and Park and Rec. Park and Rec could, in theory, proceed with looking for leasable space in town to operate the program. And we were going to start there, but we wanted to talk to you first about your thoughts on that. The RFP process, selling the land could take some time, preservation restrictions. I mean, we may not even get a bidder the first round, but you know, do you want to continue to operate that building with those departments in them for another year? You know, and if not, then we should ask Park and Rec to proceed with looking for swing space, if you will, until we find a permanent home for them.
It's a good place to pause and comments.
Well, I think you should be looking. Certainly, we're trying to move this along. We're a year into now having said we want to sell the North Hadley Village Hall. So, I mean, it's been enough time for people to think about it. You did do the public forum. I'd like to know what was the outcome of that.
They wanted to remain quiet. That's probably the best summary I can give you. They were looking for low density in terms of the occupancy of the future building. They weren't looking for any public kind of space, retail or restaurant or otherwise. They were looking for something that was more like a maybe two family residence, apartment kind of scenario with very
55 and older.
55 and older was preferred.
Tell me anything. That was a tough vote.
And they wanted to maintain.
I get closer to that. I'm okay with that.
And they wanted to maintain as much open space relative to the ballpark area as possible.
Yeah, there's a lot of talk about the ball field being sort of a pocket park or mm-hmm. park for like North Valley.
Definitely village. Some interest in that. They were not interested in anything that had more density, that brought more activity into North Valley Village.
Whatever happened with pursuing the actual boundaries?
That's all done.
That's all done.
We own the ballpark, right up to the fence, more or less, and we have
the side of the fence.
Yeah, the other side of the fence. And
going up the pool.
And there is lake access, sort of in center field, if you will. So, you know, you could, as a select board, decide you want to maintain that, and the Conservation Commission has chimed in and said they would like to maintain some access for use down the road, long term.
As the Park and Rec.
As the Park and Rec, yeah.
But we have to balance that with trying to sell it and what people would want first.
Hey, go ahead.
What was the caveat that Planning Board put on town meeting floor?
They wanted it to be solely meet existing zoning and not allow any variances. But that was turned down by town meeting.
So if somebody wanted to put four apartments in there, they could?
Yes.
With a variance.
With a variance. So that has been the position.
They don't need a variance. They were built before 1961. They could make that into apartments, could they not?
No. There's two bylaws in regards to multi-family. One is a single-family dwelling that can be, with a special permit, turned into a two-family. That's not a single-family house. You can't do that. The other one is, again, a single-family house, owner-occupied. That's out. So anything other than turning it into a single-family house has to have a variance, other than anything that fits in with the village district. Most of that is then commercial, which they prefer not to see. So now we're into this request for a variance for almost what the, to meet what they would like and probably would be the best fit as far as the village residents are concerned. And that would be a multi-family type, and they want 55 and older. They'd love to see if something like that could happen. We don't know. Until we go out and get some constructive bids back, we will not know what people, the developers, would like to see in there or what would work.
It was a nice call for people who wanted to see a coffee shop going. A couple people said they wanted a coffee shop going, remember that?
Yeah, but the building is too big for just a coffee shop, so you gotta do something with the rest of it.
I don't know, I thought it was a coffee shop.
It's a lot of coffee.
Yeah. But there was a lot of people that afterwards said no, because we brought up Echelon.
Right.
Traffic.
Yeah. So.
That's where we stand on the recommendations by the public. And it was pretty interactive. I thought there was good outcomes from it.
So I expect we're going to get all the information we need pretty soon, before the end of the fiscal year. So before the end of June, we should probably have everything we need to start putting the RFP out for selling it.
You mean the items that they have here, the status of the preservation restrictions?
Mm-hmm.
But there was no RFI's response to the project.
Right, so this is all intertwined, of course, with relocating North Hadley Fire Substation or services. Mm-hmm. And we did issue a request for information for property owners that may be interested in selling some property in the area. There was no response to that. I think maybe as a town we could have advertised that a little differently, and maybe should try to do so.
How was
by
it advertised?
Reposting it.
It was posted on TV5 on the website at Town Hall, and is published in the newspaper. And we sent RFIs directly to I want to say five or six realtors.
Okay, that's
realtors.
Well, that's
realtors.
What we would recommend. I hadn't realized that was all done. So, short of doing all that, I don't know what else we could do. There were some specific owners that we knew were interested at one point, and I don't think anyone's reached out to them over the last couple of weeks. That might have been something we could have done.
Primary line of communication is out of town right now with those.
So, at your meeting with the public up there, did they have any input on how they felt about continuing a fire department up there? Are they more concerned about the building?
That wasn't really on the agenda, Joyce, mm-hmm. and it didn't really come up. I've heard from residents in North Valley that the trend is that they would prefer to have fire services in the village or somewhere near there, but it was not part of that meeting necessarily.
The town is so spread out, I'm just sure that it's even spread further to even when that first fire station went in there. So, I mean, we're now out to Shattuck Road and down in that area and out to Sunderland. And so, I mean, we're covering a bigger piece of area than what we did even back then in the old days.
And we did request from the fire chief a study from him, an evaluation, which we have, and that was his recommendation based on time, response times and everything else. So the thought is that we're going on to the summation that there will be, we need to do something up there. But now the question is,
there's a lot that has to get done before it gets sold, and that's just my worry. If we're not sure we're going to build, or not sure what we're going to do with fire, how can we issue an RFP? If we don't know where they're going or what the answer is there, and if Park and Rec doesn't have a solution to relocate their program, then eventually they'll be a critical path. They won't be right now, but I think we should tackle all those issues.
Yeah,
exactly. Sooner.
When this article first came up, that there were two pieces to it. One was what to do with fire.
I said it three or four times. It's great that we're going to get rid of a building that we can't afford to maintain, but at the same time, we can't afford right now, with the budgets the way they are and the finances in the town in general, to rent a place for two separate departments by the month, by the year, every 6 months. We're still looking 2 or 3 years down the road, realistically, to find a place and build a place.
To build a place is going to take some time.
Yeah, but I would ask you to consider what the maintenance costs are of that property. And
fold that back into
the budgets are over $20,000 for just one of those departments in North Hadley. So,
and
you know, could that translate to paying rent somewhere? Maybe. We don't know until we look.
Consideration ever been made to take the building down and leave the fire department where it is now in existence?
That came up at the meeting. I believe that somebody made that same recommendation. I mean, it's integral to the village character, and as such is part of the reason that the district is listed as eligible for the historic register. So I think that the Mass Historic department, they would have some concerns over us taking it down. But that's not to say you couldn't consider a fire substation on the ball field. We just haven't test fit it. We know the sight lines aren't great for that location. That's a concern, but
setbacks, the turning radius, trying to get a truck in and out. These are going to be large trucks. So you're on a curb. You're also next to water. So we have a lot of multiple concerns that will trigger major issues that it might be wise to look beyond just the center. And there are some possibilities up there that are very close.
It seems to me, we need a roadmap to make a decision.
So,
and that's what we're lacking at the moment. And I think you're trying to help very much in the process. Thank you. But part of the information in my mind that's missing right now is really need a true cost-benefit analysis on various options, and we don't really have that in front of us. So it seems like we're doing a lot of speculating, all of us. You know, we're doing a lot of speculating, and I'm wondering what it would take to kind of focus in on that and put a stake in the ground and say, you know, you've got some bullets here about the preservation restrictions, the historical commission update, layout. 5 different scenarios, whatever we want to talk through.
You know, you're talking about knocking a building down in the National Preservation. I wouldn't be surprised if they would even let you build on that baseball field, being that that section is all historic.
So maybe
we need approval.
Yeah. So, we take Molly's point one step further, and we go back to what we were talking about, two items before. Maybe we need to have the consultant that we brought on board take the information we have and hash out sort of more of a cost benefit of what the options are and what they think based on their experience and what we've gathered, and push that together and start with that as our step one.
Come back to with a recommendation to both boards.
And it's part of step two.
Instead of hiring, it's kind of a no-brainer here. Instead of hiring somebody, we need a piece of property for everybody to move someplace. So that should be your first step, is to find somewhere where these people can go, and then we can address the next step in putting the building up for sale.
How big a piece of property?
Well,
how small
are the requirements?
Piece of
what services are we going
to
provide?
They have it.
Yeah. What we need to do is bring all our information together and focus it more.
Yeah.
So if we have the on-call consultant bring the information together and focus it more, if we have the fire chief who's told us he's ready to start working on some of his other tasks as far as ambulance service and some other things, we have him start pulling some of his information together. Maybe that'll help us drive this a little bit more. And then we can have Park and Rec figure out how much space, which I think they've already done, how much space they need, and what is their requirements for moving. So if we bring all those three things together as the first step, that'll give us a better picture of where we're going. At the same time, getting the RFP ready to go, because we do have to wait for our historic preservation restrictions. I have not yet said hysterical. I'm doing really well.
That's good.
Sorry. Yeah, it is you. So maybe that's the roadmap to go on.
When we put both of those questions forward in October, we went back and forth. We originally were going to go with just try to find a piece of land to relocate the fire station. And the question came up from some people. If we do that, they're going to think that later on we're going to keep North Hadley Hall and sink $6 million into that. And it's like, well, if we put North Hadley Hall forward, they're going to know where we're going to put the fire station. So we kind of put them both together in our mind, figuring that, like Joyce said, we would find a piece of land, get to working on that, in a year or two, move the fire station, which is primary. Hopefully we could find another spot for, you know, Park and Rec in the process. If, you know, that wasn't the case, then we would relocate Park and Rec at the time. But that's kind of why we brought both of those articles forward at the same time. Mm-hmm. So that people wouldn't think that, you know, we're going to build a new piece of land and then, you know, what are you going to do with North Hadley Hall? Well, we'll present them together, that once we get a fire station relocated, we'll sell off North Hadley Hall. That was the original plan.
It's pretty simplistic. We know that we have to have a fire station. We know we have parameters for that. So we have specifics there. So that, to us, is pretty solid. Park and Rec, it's a bit fluid. We can put them in a swing space now. They can go into other areas, or we can build new. And what I think that we have to start thinking of the uses of all of our buildings as a whole, and say, what is the best use of all the buildings and what fits better in the buildings, and not say this and that just because we're here. That'll give us a better focus of the 100-year plan that we're trying to come up with. And Park and Rec is the one that is a little fluid, and I think that we don't, they might not have, they don't have to be up in North Hadley. But we can put them in a swing space. So we're looking at multiple avenues here.
I actually believe fire isn't so locked in as some people believe either. I mean, as you get down through your study here, public safety comes up as being an issue.
Yes.
We need to talk about. So,
critical.
You know, is the main public safety compound, and we have to do work there, does it make more sense to do more work there versus having two stations? We, even though we are a spread out town, almost everything we have is down the central corridor. That's the biggest amount. Yes, there's a lot of housing in the north side. Yeah, not going away. It'll probably be mine that goes first if we move this everything to the central station. But there is a question. If you're going to do some more with, if we're going to look at all the buildings and all the spaces, if we say public safety needs more work, does it make more sense to put more into public safety and even change how we operate public safety?
Well, that to me is a critical issue on what our future growth of both police and fire is going to be. Mm-hmm. And right now, if you look at that building, my opinion, it doesn't fit future use.
Which building?
Public safety.
The one on the street.
So let's jump into that.
Facilities for a full-time department there. There's no facilities for a full-time ambulance there. You can't house any employees.
And it's not secure.
Exactly. So if you built a substation and made it so you could run it there, you'd have a bit of half the battle done. The other idea that I was at a few of your meetings, turn the public safety into something else right now and build another public safety building. Yeah. I mean, that was another idea.
We're back and forth.
We're a little split on that.
Yeah.
Exactly. But, you know, I think we all agree that the longevity of the building that we own is not the best we could have done back then. We could have built a better building. So now we're stuck with it. It's only 18, 19 years old. I think we're going to have a tough time convincing anyone we want to build another public safety complex. But
it is a possibility.
But we have a decent building that could be repurposed for other programs. And one thought that came up in our meeting was that there may be an opportunity to preserve the bays, maybe build out the bays in some regard, and then think about the fire and police program and maybe move into another building that's connected on the north side of the bays. So we would be switching all the back of house activities, offices and such, to the other side in a new building that was connected to the existing bays, and then we could repurpose the old portion of the fire station for either dormitories for full-time fire or for another program like parking rec or offices or anything else that don't require the same security as the police and fire activities should have in the right building. That's one option.
It's a cost scenario. So you do that, and also you do the other scenario is, all right, do you build completely new? What is the best based on cost and based on repurposing the building and what the uses are? So we got a mix of different things that could happen.
Which comes back to my point that in order for us to actually do anything, it seems like we have to cost all that stuff out. Because again, people will speculate as to what that might mean financially, and it may or may not resemble reality.
Maybe some of what we're looking for is that there are a number of different scenarios, and we've explained just a few that we've discussed. Each one, there's a lot of dependencies in how we go this way and that.
But we could likely narrow the field down to a handful.
I would like to narrow the field rather than trying to do cost analysis on whether or not we add to the north and to the south of the public safety complex versus one bay versus a new North Hadley fire station. There's a lot of different ways. So
with no disrespect to Park and Rec, but to the point that Tim was making, I mean, I think that we have greater flexibility and non-critical issues around Park and Rec as a department in town.
And public safety, absolutely.
Relative to public safety.
Absolutely.
So if we could kind of, no pun intended, park and rec to the side for the time being, and focus in on public safety and get some more concrete thinking around that as soon as possible, that would help me personally a lot, and then it's start the building blocks.
And there's ways you can help us with that. The idea of potentially having full-time fire personnel is something that plays heavily into the program. You know, whether we have dormitories that we have to build. And then the idea of ambulance service, and if that were to happen, if it would be at Center Station or in a standalone building somewhere, those are things we have to build into a program if you want them. So we would need some ideas on that.
And part of our conversation a little bit later this evening, we are going to be talking about planning this year, not just budgeting, but planning, and hopefully the budget is going to dovetail with the plan. Could happen. But part of that conversation is the concept of looking at program costs and not line items. We always have to look at line items to a point, but we really need to be looking at programming costs. So I'm hoping that we're going to start going down that path anyway of what are some of these things truly, really costing us when you pull it all together, which will help with this conversation too.
Any other comments from this? So do you want to go through the rest of your buildings?
Yes. Yeah. I'll pick an easy one. I'd say that, and I'll be wrong, but Russell School, we know that's being vacated. Do we have a vacancy date for that?
It should be it should be at the end of May.
End of May?
Yeah.
Okay, and that's fully vacated.
Call it first week in June then.
I thought there was an actual date in the...
The end of June is the actual date, and I guess they've actually paid the rent until then.
Yeah.
Right, because wasn't there a whole conversation with them about that date?
Yeah, because actually they're in their program in the middle of June, just like school does. Right.
And actually, Dan, Ken told me it was probably like the mid-June they should have most of the stuff out. But Gail said they, according to the contract and the money, it's the end of June. So.
Okay, so
I was just trying to remember what they told us when we were talking to him last.
I remember the middle of June, and a little bit of flexibility a few days. He didn't think it was going to go all the way to June 30th, but it wasn't an exact date in the middle of June.
So I guess the end of June July 1st is our, what we should say is our first.
Yeah, we just don't want to see like a soft vacancy where they store things for months at a time and you're not sure whose liability there is there.
No, do you want to schedule the yard sale for July 4th?
No, we made it pretty clear that that was it. So.
Okay. Upon vacancy, obviously we recommend there's a walkthrough that's done to ensure that the quality of the building remains as it did when they entered the building.
They actually have done updates to the inside compared to what had been there. So I think when I walked through it a couple of years ago,
Yeah, but if there's a broken pipe leaking in the basement, we want to know about it.
I don't know how you all want to handle that. There was maybe some security type deposits or otherwise that need to be. I haven't seen the lease terms and conditions, but
I think so.
So we'll just make sure it's in.
So we just need to schedule. We'll schedule a walkthrough, turnover.
Richard filmed the interior of the building before it was occupied. It was, it's on VHS. I think you still have the tapes.
It's on DVD now.
It's
on DVD, okay.
So that is our statement of condition. We'd like to put together an operations and maintenance plan for the building now that it will be vacated. You know, certain things like freeze alarms and doing certain things with the boiler to make sure that it's all in good shape. And so Gary's going to be taking kind of the point on that and putting some things together to make sure we all understand what needs to be done and keep it safe and do no harm to it as it's mothballed for the short term.
David, you said you had money put aside for mothballing it?
Yes, I do.
How much is it? You got a ballpark number, what you need?
I don't see a lot. As far as shutting off the water and shutting down the boilers and stuff like that, I'm still waiting for the insurance company to give me a detailed list of what they want to see. But, basically any freezing, your drains and that kind of stuff, and rekeying it so nobody can get in. And
freeze alarms.
Well, the heat's going to be shut off, so I'm not going to pay for that. So
we're thinking it'll be great. Cover up some of the windows.
So I have a budget of $8,800 for that building for FY16.
I think you also want to consider just mowing it, and it's not, it's still an icon within our town.
Of course.
So
absolutely.
It's going to be mowed. Electricity is going to have to stay on for the
alarms.
Do we want to move the garden?
And we still have to
move your meetings by the line.
Move their gardens.
You need more parks over here. So anyway, once it is vacated and we're able to get the consultant on board, the goal is to look at it from a seismic perspective to understand what we can do and what we can't do with the building, what kind of upgrades would be necessary to meet the current Massachusetts state building codes. And that would also dovetail into a task that we'd like to pursue, and that's looking at the fit out of Russell School for the departments which are currently in this building. We have our survey that we did last year. We got a pretty good response. We have personnel numbers and needs and everything, and I think it's enough to start to get a feasibility plan put together to see if that's a good fit. The library is also looking at it as a space, as one of their three alternatives, and they'll do that on their own as well, but we'll certainly be able to share drawings and such with them.
Is it bigger than the library?
It is, mm-hmm. Yes.
How much?
They'd have to make it handicap accessible.
They would, as would we if we were going to put the town hall there.
Yeah.
It's not partitioned that well for a library program, but it may be for offices. And it would still require vertical circulation, handicap accessibility. So there's some things we would
upstairs,
have to
do.
So one of the concerns about the accessibility was, certainly we all know based on the old Margo Jones studies and everything, that most likely it'll be something, if we do that, it'll be on the west side. We had the elevation for FEMA, the flood elevation, put on the building, so we know that. We believe that there won't be an issue if we can go down that route to put an addition on with compensatory storage and all the requirements there. So it could be made accessible with an addition and everything else. We're going forward with the survey. Hopefully we'll be able to start that the end of June, 1st of July, to get all the rest of the building surveyed. Hopefully we'll have the price by the first part of June. So we're working on that direction.
So I guess in essence, our recommendation from the committee is that it's probably the nicest building and that we own, has the most potential for a lot of reasons, and its placement in the town. It has a, it's very critical to the character of this, this town. So we'd like to repurpose it, and that's currently where the trend is in our group to do that. So we want to look at some options relative to moving apartments and making the best use of it.
Okay.
Any comments from?
I completely agree.
So do I.
The trick is then what happens here.
Mm-hmm.
If there were parking options, it would be wonderful to make this an assembly space again, where we could actually hold town meeting once in a while, or hearings or other things. But there's accessibility issues. There's parking issues primarily that we just simply can't resolve without some vacated adjacent property. That's not likely to happen. So.
Would the library be interested in this?
That's not been on their list.
No parking.
Right.
So.
I mean, I threw out a museum. Repurpose this, bring it back to the original, make it a museum.
For
that brings
Hadley,
people
Hadley
into
Hadley
the town.
Historical.
Yeah.
Yeah. You got the firm museum
an
right
idea.
Next door.
With
they're
some
both
meeting
close
space.
And adjacent.
I kind of like that.
I do too. Yeah.
Because, again, what do we have above this ceiling?
How many people have seen that?
Yeah. And when you see it, you go, why did it ever get covered up? Yeah. We have the original windows still there. We have the original transoms, the original ceiling, and it all can be brought back. And it's gorgeous. And if people did see that, if we put that on, that's one thing that they'll say, yeah, bring it back to what it was, because it's gorgeous.
It'll be Oopai Shoopai on Saturday nights again.
They didn't do that back then.
Yeah, that was before that.
But we have so much stuff, historical stuff, that's stuck in every place and cubby, and no one sees this stuff. Bring it out. Let people see it. Get people to come. And what does that do? That just brings people into the town more and more. And it helps all the businesses. So maybe that's a good thing to look at.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, we don't have any other ideas for Town Hall if it does become vacated to move there, but it's the site's so highly constrained. Yeah.
Yeah, we're worried that when we get the survey, it might not include the parking lot.
It might not. Yeah, that's
interesting.
We'll know. Soon.
We will know.
Okay,
so let's move on to Senior Center. You do know that we've begun the repair of the roof, replacement of the flat roof on the rear area portion of this building.
Saw the flags.
That's going to buy us quite some decent time to use that as a swing space if necessary. The current functions in there can remain in a safer environment, and you know, taking care of the drainage improvements on site. So it's in good shape for the short term. Long term, we know there's a lot of upgrades that would be necessary to repurpose it. Electrical, mechanical, virtually every system is obsolete and too small. So there's a lot involved there. One of the library concepts is to think about either adding on in the northerly direction or connecting to the front portion of Hooker School, using that building per se, maybe not the back portion. We don't think it lends itself very well to community program in terms of the split level and the lack of accessibility. So we're tending to unanimously support doing something like ultimately removing the back portion and thinking about that property for potential of a community center or other public function. That is a very long, narrow parcel. It goes all the way back. Continues all the way to the Legion parking lot. You know, we'd recommend considering purchase of the adjacent property. It's not for sale, but it would buy you enough width to think about more like a town campus, you know, with multiple buildings or a park and rec / senior center function, community center behind Hooker School portion, where the newer portion is, and beyond that into the field. So that's where we're trending right now as a committee.
You're talking about just
recommend that.
You had a picture frame shop, that piece of property there?
You know where we're, yeah.
And you could go to the street side too.
Well, exactly.
Right, right.
That would, you know, there's potential including
that
frontage along the road as well.
I think there's been a lot of people that have come to us that like the town center concept and the fact that things are here. And that is an ideal property for that. The front portion of Hooker School is smaller than you think. When you look at it from the road, it looks fairly large. It's not. It's small. It's partitioned up. If we were to use it, it would probably be a complete gut of that of the inside, and just maintaining the shell of the building, the old building, and repurposing it that. But you know, even for that, we're struggling with program that would actually fit in there in the end.
We need to see what the library comes up with.
Yeah, we'd like to see what the library comes up with before we make a formal recommendation. But I think that property would serve the town well for community buildings in the future.
And that library, that's moving along on schedule, so.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which way?
Which way?
Forward.
I would suspect recommendations from the library committee in the fall.
Yeah.
For both. So they're collaborating with us as much as possible.
There's no rumors about losing money in that, so
maybe.
Correct. We haven't really engaged the programs that are currently at the senior center, and I think that's high on our list to talk to everybody about what the long term needs would be. And I know they've had at least one meeting about what the seniors would prefer to see, and I think there was a trend towards a newer building. Mm-hmm. You know, so I think everyone's thinking the same thing, but we have to hammer out the program and make some decisions.
They've been talking to the people across the room. They've been talking to the seniors across the room.
All this gets done, we're going to have people moving from Hadley to Amherst.
So we can't pay our $8 million liabilities now, but we just spent about $100 million this evening.
No, I don't think that. We have to look at what the town did 100 years ago.
Yeah.
We put up a lot of buildings quickly.
I think.
And I think we're at that point that we have to make some really hard choices. We all know it's going to be money.
Yeah, and we spoke about a 20-year program that we looked at that didn't work for our municipal buildings right now.
We need
to look 60, 80 years down the road like they did 100 years mm-hmm. ago. But we can't ignore that.
Unfortunately,
we can't do it all at once
for 100 years and really didn't put a lot of money into it.
Yeah.
Set the money aside.
So before you go to your next building,
yeah.
Let me kind of sum up what I think you're saying about the senior center. The senior center is kind of the building with the new roof, buys us time and buys us space to do swinging and couple other things. So there's really not many things you're talking about changing in the near future with the senior center, are you?
Correct. That's how we feel at this time. That's right.
Okay.
Comments from the board? Anyone have any ideas? Okay. The library is really easy because they've taken their own destiny they're on top of things, and their plan should play out over the summer in terms of what they want to do and where they might go. So we're continuing to just communicate with them, think about some ideas on how we could use that space or this space. The building is in good shape. They're using the basement level right now for programs, and that's not a great space to use, but it's not conducive, right? But they're making the best of it, so we'll continue to see how they do. Public Works, we are obtaining a survey there because there's some question about how much property we have, where the setbacks are pertaining to wetlands, how much space we really do have, that's in play. The longer-term understanding of the wastewater treatment facility has been something that we as a committee really can't get our hands around. I mean, there's varying opinions as to whether that facility will be big enough in the long run. If current technologies have changed to the point that we're not needing as much capacity in the long run, or if we would regionalize that service, We just don't know, and we're not, it's honestly, it's not our specialty to tell you all if you're gonna need more space for them, and that plays into the Department of Public Works needs for that property. So that's something, I don't know who can decide that, but it needs to be discussed. There was a plan that's now 10 years old that recommended that that would have to expand significantly, but honestly, over the last 10 years, technologies have changed, there's other ideas, so I don't know if you want to revisit it, or if you know, how to proceed with that. I think our committee's kind of hit a wall on that one.
Well, we know that, obviously, that's the 800-pound gorilla down there, whether or not, if there needs to be something that would have, what could we then do with the remainder of the site? So, if that question really needs to get resolved before we can figure out if we're going to, that, and how big is the site really, before it really makes it harder to see.
Yeah, originally there was a lot of talk about expanding it. Back when Callahan had that property, they wanted to take a little bit more of it so they could physically double the size of the plant, double the size of the flow. We're only 560,000 gallons right now, what it's designed for. So, the other option, in the meantime, since I got on a board 2 years ago and speaking with another board member about different issues, if we went into regionalizing, there's a possibility that we could divert some of the flow probably to Amherst at some point.
Well, look at the new
technologies.
But
we don't know what the cost would be.
Look at the new technologies that are coming up.
Well, you're chasing leaks in the system. That's improving.
Yeah. New technologies is really something to look at, definitely. Yeah.
And look at what some of the other states are doing with residential housing.
Yeah,
with, they're not hooking them up.
With pre-treatment and everything else.
So we're recharging.
The two items we think in the short term could benefit that department, and it's really a question as to how long we would stay there, is the you know, recommendation for a truck wash, you know, to wash fleet vehicles to improve the longevity of those vehicles when they come in after sanding and salting. That was one, and the other was that we've got some field trailers that were strung together to serve as offices. I think, Gary, they're 20 years old now, and one was almost 30 years old. They're not the best places to house personnel. And whether you could look at some kind of FEMA overstock trailers or find some other means to improve that, but
they're tired, and I think we need to really seriously, on a short-term goal, look at something else for them.
It's a morale issue, if nothing else.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So we don't want to prioritize this low and then have persons have to reside there for very long. And then also the vehicle wash bay would help you with fleet issues.
That's an investment.
You know,
bus wash.
And before the DPW, when the sewer commissioners were still in place, they had office space over at the senior center, which I believe there's two or three spaces over there, which they probably could utilize a couple of those spaces.
Those are the options, so we have to look at that.
They were there, and they moved into the trailers at some point.
Yeah.
Maybe just because of proximity of the operation, but without, again, the other, of course, thing is the DPW director and lack thereof. In order to have a long-term goal for that department, what the needs are, we need to have to talk to somebody about that. So
that's underway.
Right.
So the committee was put together last meeting.
Yes. Yeah.
What's the timeline that we're possibly looking at?
The committee was put together last meeting, so we need to just have our first meetings and go through the applications, and then so in a couple
so
of months,
couple
3 months,
yeah,
probably 3 months at the most.
Mm-hmm. I don't.
That's probably where that one is.
I don't think our committee sees that as a priority by any means. I think it's probably the lowest priority at this time.
Except for the office trailers.
Except for the office trailers.
Maybe some storage. And we should realistically look at how the building's utilized. If maybe there's a little lean-to or something that could be added on. Just some ideas that give them a little bit more space, a little bit better.
We do have upgrades going on, closing the pole barn, siding and roofing and doors and windows. And so there's some state of good repair upgrades that are ongoing there, which will improve matters.
And save money.
You've been working with Mike up until this point, or no?
Mike's come in and given us his summary of their operations, and that was very useful at the time. So that's been great. Maybe the longer term plans is something that we really haven't discussed.
I know I had committees over there and building committees looking at the DPW, and one of the scenarios was on the north side of the building to add offices, let's say, behind the existing trailers that were there. And there was talk of buying some of that, per se, Callahan land so that we could expand our operation. There was talk of, you know, a wash bay, Dufresne and Henry, which is Stantec, did a study on that. I believe I gave it with, left it with Guilford to look at. I mean, there's a lot of different things that come into play there. How much bigger are we going to get? How many more roads are we going to have in the next 20, 30, 40 years? How much more personnel are we going to have there? That all takes effect, and we're on this little postage stamp, as everybody says. But, you know, if you repurpose some of that, you probably could get your offices in there. I mean, our finance committee was there years ago, looked at the same site. Nothing really has changed down there since, you know, they looked at it, let's say, which was 15 years ago or so.
I mean,
except for the trailer.
That building, when they moved into it, was, what, 40 years ago now already, probably?
1972.
72, 45 years, huh, or so? 43 years. Yeah. So, you know, we grew out of that building in that amount of time.
Definitely.
And like I said, not to say what's going to happen with the wastewater.
And Mike brings up a good point. You got to look at the overall town with regard to growth. You know, quite honestly, there's a lot of different scenarios on what can happen. Do we change zoning slightly to do more stuff within villages instead of keeping on increasing roads? You know, there's a lot of different things, and that is critical for a lot of issues that we've just talked about. You know, we have zoning that is now 50 years old. It might be wise to start thinking about different ways of growth within the villages, within the areas that, you know, we have these archaic sized lots. Every single time that we keep on growing our lots to 200 feet and look at some towns at 600 feet, what do? You're just creating greater infrastructure.
Well, we lose farmland
and we lose
we get lawn.
Right. Yeah. So, and we have so much preserved land. We really don't have much area that we can grow. And we have to look at that. We've got to seriously have a committee to look at future zoning with regard to where we're going to go. Let's stop the flood streets.
Yeah. Long range planning does a bit of it. But Pioneer Valley planning, we're not involved with at all for the most part, you know, and we should be more involved with them and see the direction the whole county, the whole this end of the state's going in right now. With the rail, with the colleges, you know, all this stuff is coming in and affecting us in the long run.
But part of what Tim was saying was addressed, part of some of the other topics that we've talked about tonight. The Long Range Planning Committee, we did come up with some recommendations for higher density zoning in certain areas. There's a lot of work and effort and studies that were put into that thing. And granted, it's a little dated now, but some of it still applies.
It's being updated, I believe.
Yeah. Particularly given the, you know, some of the building questions that we talked about, even locations of some of the municipal services, a lot of that was explored.
There's absolutely two schools of thought with that. Alexandra, God rest her soul, if she was here, would be arguing significantly that the larger lots are better for the community. So there's two schools of thought regarding that. And I know the planning board is afraid of a higher density and what we would actually what we would open ourselves up to at that point in time.
Well, it's not
a higher density everywhere, just clusters.
Yes. Cluster it.
Yeah.
But the cluster aspect was.
You build it on the east side of town next to your neighbor, so it's prevailing winds blow.
We have an actual lot right over here that, you know, they'd love to do that with the current owner of the property. Right over here would love to do that so that he could, you know, get a greater density there and kind of open it up to an over 55, you know, and bring smaller projects in there so that we could have a location. But I know.
You don't have to maintain more open space like that.
Yeah. Honestly, I think John's point about Pioneer Valley Plan is a good one. Other communities are talking about road diets. They're talking about increased density villages, traffic calming. You know, we're talking about bigger roads. We're talking about widening things and making large property. You know, so maybe we ought to rethink that and get some professionals to give us some advice.
The state's going to make four lanes all the way through Hadley, whether we like it or not. And, you know, that's been in the works for years.
We know that, but we're talking about the other roads.
Is there any other properties that the town owns right now that have not been surveyed? Do we know?
We have Zaterka Field.
Yes,
we have that. We don't know about the schools. That hasn't been part of our purview, but I would suspect that elementary school is probably got a survey.
They're surveyed.
Hopkins was surveyed because we were going to do an addition.
The addition on that, yeah. I mean, I know the town owns several different plots that. Most of them aren't really anything we could build on, and there's some cemeteries that probably don't have actual surveys. But as far as like the main buildings that we're looking at,
they're all surveyed now.
We're going to have one. We've got the money.
So, do we want to dive in a little bit for some discussion on where we think we should go with buildings next, or should we?
Well, I thought we were going. Are we going to put out another RFI for property in North Addison? Since we have no respondents from the last one.
I think we should.
What was the window on that?
2 weeks?
No, I gave them more time than that. It's like 3 weeks or something like that, maybe more.
It sounded like a pretty good advertising campaign that you described, but maybe there's a little more kind of boots on the ground kind of communication between us and property
owners. When will your advocate be back? When will your advocate be back?
Tomorrow.
Let's redo it.
So why don't we take what we sent out, your advocate, and you guys can go through it again, and we'll try to send it out one more time.
Leave it out there for a month.
Send it out mid June, and leave it until the end of July and see what comes back in.
Give a bigger window.
Yeah.
Is there any other way we can advertise that works? Can we put flyers in things? Or I don't know.
We'll
need your direction.
Business West.
Do we have any water bills or anything going on in the next?
Those are full up. We've already loaded that freight train as much as it goes.
In August. That's too late.
So we missed the deadlines on that. So.
I mean, you can still. You can put it on. You can put the announcement you have it out there on Craigslist. You can put it. You know.
Yeah. And you put a banner across North Hadley Hall. We need land up here.
any advertised, any way that you can get the word out on any kind of a bid is fine. Just as long as we don't compromise the principles of fair and free competition.
Right. You got to tell everybody. So if the advocate tells somebody, you should just walk to every house and tell everybody, and then be done with it.
Unless he already knows of interest.
I don't know, this is getting pretty good. I might want some lines.
You're in residential.
Yeah, it don't work.
There was a proper size that we had in the RFI that, I mean, it was kind of a shot in the dark. We know what we think the program should be, and I think the acreage might have been three acres was minimum.
Well, actually, what we said was we were interested in any property, but we would be giving preference to properties that met, I think there were 10 criteria that you listed.
Okay. So we can do it one more time.
Sure.
So then also, I really think we should move forward with Russell School.
Mm-hmm.
So the consultants do the seismic analysis, so we know if we actually have a building that we can save or a building we can't save. Because that's pretty much what that will tell us. Mm-hmm. And then once we know if we can save the building or not save the building, then we can decide to move on from there.
Okay.
We're waiting for June for the historical feedback on North Hadley Hall.
In advance of that, I'll work with David to prepare an RFP that includes kind of a preference towards the uses that were described in the public meeting. You know, we talked about a ranking system. I don't want to complicate things too much, but we did talk about a ranking system such that properties that are owners that want to purpose that land within what the townspeople think it should be would get a better ranking, if you will, in the proposals. And if this is only one or two, I mean, it might be a moot point if we don't get enough respondents, but and that could happen. But if we do have a number of them, I'd like to sort of lean it towards the right use for the town.
The draft you put together was really good, yeah. I think that if you tailor a little more to what the people said in the present session, that might would be really good.
Okay, so I'll work with David on
but it was very good to begin with.
I'd like that to be teed up so when Historic Commission comes with the preservation restrictions. I will tell you that initially they said they wanted to preserve not only the building but the land as part of the restriction, like the land remained untouched.
Bacon,
which
yes.
really ties the hands of an owner if they can't put parking in certain areas or they can't put certain kinds of landscaping. So there may be some give and take there. I've not seen the draft version of the PRs, but I'd caution us to not go crazy and then have it so that no one can do anything.
I'm concerned we're there already with that piece of property. Because I think if the neighbors are so concerned about it being about what actually is going to be there, no traffic, not apartments, no coffee houses. Well, what do you got? I mean, what's left?
A vacant lot.
What's left?
That's only dictated what we prefer, but it doesn't tie the hands of the respondents to the RFP. They could still put those in if it meets the current zoning restrictions.
Not without going, which is what? One family house.
Or business. It could be a business as long as the parking is met, the parking restrictions are met.
It's going to be a change of use, so it's going to need permission from the neighbors anyways, is it not?
Depending on what that use is, yes, it could go in front for a special permit.
If it's a vacuum cleaner store versus park and rec, that's a change of use.
But it doesn't really go before the neighbors, it goes before the
zoning
board.
Which,
zoning
by the way, would have to notify all the abutters.
Yes.
Is that side zoned business, or is it the opposite side that's zoned business?
It's on both sides.
It's on both sides.
That is his own business.
Limited business.
So then I think that's for that piece of property, that's where we need to kind of guide this one towards it. Mm-hmm. So then to talk about the feasibility, we talked a little about doing some feasibility for public safety. Maybe we ought to talk to our consultant again and see, can he come up with some rough numbers for sizes? Just generic sizes. What would you be your sizes for this, this, and this? I mean, get the fire chief involved and the police chief involved and talk about what would the sizes be and then what do we have now and what would be the additions.
Again, we have to mimic that with you. What's the growth?
It is.
That's serious. We need direction on it.
But I think there's, from what you said, there's some deficiencies in the building now. Mm-hmm. So you can start with what we have now and work on that, and then as we work together, we can put some more stuff in there.
And we can work off the studies that we have based on their recommendations and what the chiefs see. And that's what we'd like to do.
So is there anything else you want to kind of guide them that we'd like to see done as well? Or?
With that, there may be a phasing plan in terms of a full build option versus a what we need today option. Mm-hmm. You know, so I mean, I think that would be part of any process that we have in terms of programming, but I would stress that.
Well, I would hope in a building and design that it would be an option to add on to that building at some stuck down here with what we have that we really can't build off of?
Well, you look at it as a cost analysis on both ways. You have to look at the two options of the building. And then you make that decision. It's pretty simplistic then.
Well, you're not going to put a full force fire department up in North Hadley.
No.
But you're going to need, and I guess that's the call of the substation remaining in North Hadley. And the call is from the North Hadley residents that they would like to continue to have some type of coverage in North Hadley. So you're not looking to put a full-size building up in North Hadley. You are looking to put up a building that will serve that area and have some apparatus up there to take care of that area.
Correct.
So there's not much brain tossing here on that part.
And I mean, another option is, you know, 50 years or 40 years down the road, if they do decide to go to a full-time, that's a building up there that you can repurpose for something else.
You can repurpose it for just keeping your other thick apparatuses in that you don't use all the time.
Chief?
I had met with the building committee just because I understand that there's going to be a time delay here and that you need more information, we need more cost-benefit analysis and everything. But there's some immediate needs for that building in order for us to continue parking vehicles there. For example, the new truck that we're working on the specs on, in order to get the truck that needs to go up there, there's some minimum stuff that needs to be done. So that needs to be funded. That's been in capital for 5 years now. So it's obviously not that full capital amount, but there needs to be some work done. We need to move the oil tank. We need to potentially take out some of the door frame in order for the truck to fit in. We're replacing a door that's falling out. You know, so there's some basic things that need to be done in the interim. So that needs to be funded at some point because that money's not in my budget. So
when's new truck coming?
It's a minimum of 10 months out. So, but we have stuff parked outside right now at our center station. So when we're talking about a museum here, I got a couple pieces that can move right in.
But it could vary. We need to talk to him. And is some space around here that we could get to get some of that stuff out there. But he always has to get to almost all of it anyway. So it restricts where our museum and just leave it near the front door.
All right. So is there anything else you want to talk about with buildings tonight?
I would just simply advocate that some of you join us once in a while for our meetings and participate in the conversations. It's lively and interesting in our minds. Some of you have been there, and I do appreciate that, but we could use all the input we could get.
You don't think you're that entertaining on
channel 5? Absolutely not.
On that 192.
And as you know,
seems like it could be a little,
we're actually not. We're not to be televised any longer, unfortunately.
Right.
So, but that even lends itself to asking us more for people to come live so that we can get all the input we can. I mean, there's people that listen and provide commentary the next week. But I'd like to have people there in the conversation as we discuss.
I'm bad to ask this, but what nights do you have your meetings?
They've been changing. That's
yeah. We've had some conflicts, but we're on to Tuesdays now. Meeting night.
Savings planning board.
Yeah. Yes.
Do we have an answer about the $66 project?
We can take care of that.
Yeah, we're taking care of that.
That's not a problem.
And we don't have an answer for the monies that have been left over on projects that are completed.
Yeah, there's two things that have to be done.
Okay.
One is you have to look at the wording of the articles to see if it's easy to move the money. And if it's not easy, then we have to reappropriate it.
We just need to make sure we do it the right way.
Next time, but how about, I actually redid the numbers and it's over $8,000. I mean, it's not a lot of money, but if it knocks one other thing out of the projects that you have listed, but what you're saying is we can't do anything until fall town meeting to repurpose
unless the wording is found to work for us.
And what you're looking at is what we know about. If there's been additional deletion or, expenditures from the accounts,
Some of those accounts are some of the money might not be exact on some of them, and some of them were stuff that we set aside, like the senior center, that one that's been there for 4 or 5 years possibly, that was set up before us. So some of the accounts are some that we set up at the fall.
I think Gail had a summary that we
I've got the other forms of here with the package.
It might be for you.
But she had it, sorry.
Do you anticipate any other ones that the bids have come in higher than what was allocated on town meeting floor?
Well, the big one's going to be very shortly, so other than that, no.
That
one's been pretty good.
That one's due next Tuesday?
We got the filed sub bids today.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the rest
Wednesday. Wednesday is the GC.
So we're not long away for that one.
Yeah.
Are you every Tuesday?
We're every other Tuesday, starting
second
of June.
16th and 30th.
Where can we find the agenda? Will there be an agenda beforehand? Or is that?
We generally post a generic agenda because it tends to become the same conversation about, you know, the big picture and each building. And so it hasn't really changed all that much. Some of it is reactionary to town meeting warrant articles and such, and critical needs and projects that are active. So there's not really any need to make it more detailed than that at this time.
Well, so tonight, your next meeting, get going on Russell School.
Yeah.
We have a few funds to work on.
I think we have some things that we could feed the project consultant promptly and get some activities going and some ideas to get back to you soon.
It sounds like he's going to be a resource that we're going to, or they are going to be a resource that we go to considerably, particularly at the beginning of this curve.
Yeah, it could very well be October, but I have to get more money.
I was going to say $33,000 yeah, might go pretty fast.
We just came up with quite a few to add for the list tonight. So.
Yeah.
Especially the initial search.
I don't know. I find that the architects seem to be pretty darn reasonable lately. It's really strange.
Good.
Any questions?
Are you an architect?
No, I'm just working with architects. Not my experience.
You work with architects.
All right, so thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much.
You're doing a great job. You guys are doing an excellent job. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
All right, so now let's go into figure talks.
We're never going to finish all these tonight.
So look, Molly, you want to kick off?
So, just go to that. All right, I mean, so just to get the conversation kicked off, what I tried to do is just, first of all, summarize some of the issues that I think need to be addressed as we move forward, kind of things that are working, but things that may not be working very well. So just kind of bearing in mind, I'm just going to run through those quickly. You know, I think one of the biggest issues we have relative to planning and budgeting around here has to do with just the general topic of communication. Communication between the department heads, the town administrator, and the select board seems like oftentimes we're kind of going back and forth and saying, well, what actually happened? Who said? No, that's not what I understood. I've heard from several department heads over the course of the year that they felt that, we heard it at a couple of our meetings, that they felt that the communication after a decision is made or a recommendation is made doesn't go back to them for further comment. So I think that those are some of the things that we need to fix sooner rather than later. The roles and responsibilities of the select board liaison positions, if we're going to continue with the liaisons, I think that's up for discussion. But you know, if we are going to do that, I think we need to be really clear on what the expectation is of that position, what authority position has, what it doesn't have. I think we tried to start that at the beginning of the year by saying, okay, we'll get regular updates, but just, yeah, these things, we tend to not follow through. Gets busy, right? Also between the select board and town residents, I don't think that I think we can do a better job trying to engage the residents. Have some ideas relative to that. And then things like, you know, audit results and management letter, they're things that seem like they really should be coming in front of the select board and be like a standing agenda item that we just get an update on a regular basis. And again, topics come up and then they kind of disappear off of future agendas. So that's one area I'm hoping that we can address by, you know, kind of reforming how we're going to march forward here. Multi-year budget planning versus single-year balancing act, a little bit of what I was talking about when the building committee was here. I think it's obvious that we have issues relative to the quality of the input into the budgets, the accuracy of the input, the comprehensiveness of the input, understanding what's in, what's not in, all of that. I think we need to move away from a line item focus to departmental programming focus. We get so mired into the detailed line items of the budget that we never really discuss the big issues, like what do the residents want to pay for? You know, what services are we providing and making sure that we're going back and asking the town, is this what you want? You know, do you want all of these departments? Do you want all of these services? And we may be surprised at the answers that we get back. So I think that, you know, this goes back to kind of engaging.
Example.
We just talked about buildings right here, yeah, as to what is the priorities of the residents. Yeah. I mean, if you were, I was listening to that.
She's talking about departments.
Yeah.
Well, services.
Police services. Fire service.
School service. A very simple example, some towns, that doesn't apply to us, but I mean, some towns for years had roadside trash pickup. And they decided that, you know, after a while that they weren't going to do that anymore, that it was possible to outsource that, and the town got away from providing roadside trash pickup. We were doing street sweeping, mm-hmm, right? It's a service that we're no longer providing. It was a conscious decision. So things like that, but we don't really talk about those things an
awful lot. It's a service we've reduced.
Pardon?
It's a service we've reduced.
Right. But, you know, again,
just
what?
Just in case my DEP is watching, it's a service we reduced.
Right, yes, I'm sorry. Forgive my language, yes. But again, we need to remember that.
I mean, most of that we tried to do. You know, we're doing a cost analysis on the ambulance service, whether we are to privatize or start our own service, or I think we go into them pretty thoroughly when we do discuss them, but yes, they're usually left open-ended and never followed through on a lot of them.
Yeah, we just kind of keep kicking some critical decisions down the road.
Because the next level after we do an analysis would be to ask a non-binding referendum whether or not they think it's a good idea.
Exactly.
Yeah, potentially, and I think part of that, we talk about having public hearings.
And I'm 100% behind that. Put it on a ballot and non-binding referendum and let the people decide.
Yeah. Okay. We need to integrate capital planning into the budget process. I, you know, again, tend to look at them a little bit separately, but I think we need to do a better job of that. Inclusion of a full-time equivalent trend analysis. You know, there was some information put in the budget books this year, but, you know, oftentimes I'm sitting there wondering how many people, you know, how much has that department grown over the past 5 years? And it's not right in front of us. You know, I think we need to have more information during the budget cycle. Lack of sufficient information to make informed decisions. Just the board material format and dissemination of information. Bridget was very helpful. We had that board docs in front of us about a year ago. Yeah, we just never made a decision. I missed that meeting, but I definitely remember it being in the material.
Yeah.
And my recollection was that people responded to it favorably, but yet we never made a decision to say, yes, we're definitely going to do that, or no, it's a bad idea. Personally, I mean, just from the sheer volume of paper that I wind up recycling, multiplying that by all of us, let alone everything else through town hall, I think that in and of itself would pay for it.
In the last 2 years, I have four copy paper boxes full of things that I want to keep, that I want to look over throughout the years.
I thought that was a bonus, is that all the extra scrap paper we get?
Yeah, that's right, you can turn it over and color on the back.
No, some of it was written on both sides.
But it's also ease of access to information, because a lot of times we're saying, oh, yeah, we talked about that three meetings ago, but if you don't have the book in front of you, and then sometimes David's very good about bringing a bunch of volumes over here, but if we had that service, we could just quickly flip to it and keep moving along instead of, again, kicking a decision down the road until it comes back to us. The wage study, enough said on that. Identification of key goals and objectives. If we don't identify those up front and have the budget match what we're trying to achieve, you know, it was like we do the budget and then we talk about key objectives later on, if we ever get to them. I think we need an ongoing update and status of major issues and projects. Again, this has to do, you know, with the agenda and what we're spending our time on at our meetings. Integrating the existing information. My God, we've done study after study after study. You know, several of them are years old now, but I couldn't tell you in the fire study. I remember it was like about 222 pages or something like that, but I couldn't tell you right now what was implemented, what wasn't implemented, if it wasn't implemented, why it wasn't implemented, and what of it is still relevant. We went through some of that because we were doing the police search recently, so we went back to the acting chief and had obtained an update, but that really should be, that should be in front of all of us right now. And then developing a budget and planning calendar that we can, you know, that we agree to. So I just put together a proposed timeline. There's nothing, you know, set in stone in my mind about this, but I was just trying to kind of outline on a month-by-month basis what we might be looking at. I'm worried that maybe some of it's a little bit too, maybe too aggressive with vacations and the like in the summer. But it isn't just a budget outline. It's really, you know, focusing on some level of organizational planning. There are many towns that go through a full-blown strategic planning process. They go out, they hire a facilitator, they bring somebody in, their brainstorming sessions, their focus groups. I am not suggesting that. I don't think that we're, I don't think that would be the best use of our time.
But and money.
And money, right. But I think that we can, as a board, make a decision to do a better job integrating more people into the conversation, putting the planning up front, really honing in on some key objectives relative to what our forecasting looks like before we get into the budget cycle, rather than trying to do it simultaneously. I think we've done a much better job over the past year or two, but I think we still have a long way to go, and I heard that loud and clear from a lot of the employees who are frustrated as hell. That it's just one more year and nothing seems to really change, and that's our responsibility. We're the leadership. What?
No.
You don't agree with that?
Actually, a lot's kind of changed.
Mm-hmm. I think a lot's changed too in the year or two.
So.
Go ahead.
What?
More.
Oh, well, I mean, I don't, you know, necessarily.
So
I think I should get into all of this. I mean, this
right.
was put in front of you
right.
guys to see what, you know, what do you think?
So of all the things you talked about, I think there's some things we should kind of talk more about tonight. And definitely the liaison thing, I think, it's been going on for quite a while. Last year wasn't the first year. It's been going on for many, many years.
Many, many years.
And we do need to tighten that up. So the question I would say is, you know, does everybody agree with that? And how do we want to re-divvy up the liaison assignments this year? And then what do we want to set as sort of a goal for ourselves as liaisons for coming back to the select board reporting?
What do you see as the job of the liaison? They're not going to replace the select board, but it's somebody to be kept informed of their issues, ongoing issues, somebody to be called in. If you think something needs to be addressed or not addressed, or, you know, or here's what the select board thinks regarding planning for the current year. Here's, you know, here I'm liaison to Michael, and I go into Michael's office and or to, you know, DPW, and I say to Michael, this is what we're doing. This is how it's going to be laid out. Please post this somewhere. make sure everybody in your department understands it, if they have any questions to ask you regarding it. Do you understand? Is there any questions you have for us? Is that, what is it you envision the liaison to be?
Well, if you got a communication problem between the department heads, the administrator, and the select board right now to start with,
yeah,
then why wouldn't you want to talk to everybody in that whole department if you're a liaison for them? I've been for the last year going office to office in this town hall numerous times to numerous departments. They don't have any major issues. There's really been nothing been brought back, you know, to the board.
Been there in the last week?
No,
I was just going to say.
No, no. I tried to. I was just going to stay out of that conversation right now, but no, I have not. But over the past year, I think I've been in contact with everybody here. David, I stop in here on Mondays most of the time, speak with you, Bridget, and I go through the offices, you know, periodically. So, but I try to talk to all of the employees, you know, not just the department heads.
So an individual select board member can make decisions on behalf
either
of the
way,
board.
Exactly.
So correct. We're all clear on that. But the department heads find it extremely useful to know that they do actually have a contact person for the purpose of providing information that on important issues that may come up from time to time. And particularly if there's a lag between select board meetings, 2 to 3 weeks, where a decision doesn't need to be made, but information needs to be disseminated, and to do that in such a way that they can contact a liaison, know that they've had a chance to talk to a liaison, they haven't violated any open meeting laws or anything like that. Department heads find that very, very useful for a variety of different reasons. So it's really a form of communication. It's connecting the select board directly to departments. And I don't think that happened prior to the liaison system, except when you had individuals who were particularly engaged with the business of the town. So it was kind of an idiosyncratic process beforehand.
So I guess, question I have about the liaison thing is I think the concept of a liaison serves a useful purpose, as you stated. But nor do I think that the existence of a liaison should supplant good communication with the departments as part of our planning process. I mean, I think that there are, when we're talking about strategic planning and looking at short range and long range goals, I think that needs to be, all of us need to be doing that directly with the department heads, either here or we're going to them or whatever. To me, if that's happening, then the role of the liaison is maybe relegated a little bit, and it really just becomes more of a check-in, like you're saying, between meetings. Is there something brewing? Is there something good happening that we should all be made aware of, and that kind of thing? But I wouldn't want to see the liaison become
the channel.
The channel, right. We want to be very careful with that.
Yeah, I mean,
I think I've only touched base with the guys in the fire department go down maybe twice in this year, because it's hard when it's usually on nights when we have a select board meeting to go into when they're doing their fire, have their meeting and doing their drills, and I did get to see them do some drills the last time I was there and touch base with them and just ask them how things are going, and went to a couple of the different functions at Red's retirement and things like that nature, and just make an appearance and make sure they know that you're there and supporting them. I mean, I think that's part of that liaison there. And the police department, it was kind of like this past year, touching base with the acting police chief and talking to the guys throughout the department on different occasions, not only as a sounding board, not as anything else, you know, not offering anything that would come from a select board, but just if they had any issues or anything they wanted to, you know, talk about, just again letting them know that you're there and supporting them in that they can come to if there's a problem.
And I think that's exactly what the liaison is supposed to be.
Exactly.
And that's it.
And at any time, any employee or department head or anybody can individually talk to the Board of Selectmen.
Nobody on the liaison is there to micromanage any department.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. You don't make any decisions, but if we've got an upcoming event that's going to be in front of us and they feel that they need to talk to the board, they should be able to. Absolutely.
There's no reason why they can't.
So I think we all agree that the liaison's purpose is to be the sounding board and sometimes maybe the vent receiver for the department heads to help them along, but then the department heads are still talking to the town administrator and passing information on to the town administrator, and the town administrator is still passing information on to the select board, and that.
Lots of times the issues are passed on to you and you as being chairman this past year,
right.
So a lot of different issues were directed to you, and that's the way that it should go. And then if it's you feel that it needs to be brought forward.
I agree with that. But then the other part,
chain of command.
So the other part I believe the liaison is also they get to know the department more, so that when we actually have to divide up and do some duties like negotiating for police and fire, that liaison knows a little more, can go into that. We've got to negotiate with DPW, that liaison would go with DPW. If there's an issue with some type of finance thing, that liaison would go in and be the spearhead from the select board to help with that. So that's the other piece no one really mentioned, but I see that as
I think we opened up the communications with this tri-board, I mean, 100% from what had happened before. Most all of the finance committee I spoke with and a lot of the school committee I spoke with, and they're real happy with the tri-board setup, you know. I am real happy with it, you know. The public knows what's going on now, you know.
So I think we all agree liaison is where we want to go, and we want to keep doing it, and we all agree with how we're supposed to do it.
As a past selectman, there wasn't a week I didn't stop in to see Michael or Dennis Huckowitz or talk to the finance committee was less often, but there wasn't a month go by where I didn't speak to somebody in every single department. Michael wasn't there at that point in time. But I checked in 5 times a year with the fire chief as well, just to touch base with him. I'm a lot more flexible than the rest of you with your schedules. I have time in my afternoons, and I probably am not obtrusive, but I spend a lot of time talking. And I think David will adhere to that too, admit to it too, that I spend a lot of time talking to everybody. I don't need to stop that, do I?
No.
Okay.
But we also, that brings a good point, Jerry. I mean, to the extent people do have different schedules because we're volunteers here, but we as elected officials need to be available to people. So we need to have a phone number that's published where people can reach us. Most of the folks I talk to kind of know, you know, best time to get me is early in the morning or at the end of the day, but if they leave a message during the day, I'll try to call them back.
Bridget's got like my number, and when there's a problem, she just gives it to them.
So how about we wrap up the liaison discussion?
Mm-hmm. Okay. But I think that should be part of it.
Yeah. Well, I was going to put that in the communication part next.
Okay, all right.
So we need to decide how we want to do liaisons this year, since we might as well do it now. Any thoughts, goals?
It would be helpful if I listed the liaison positions from prior years.
Do we not have a copy
of that?
Three pages is over.
It's a general government, public safety, education, public works, and then the human services, culture, and rec.
That's right.
So does anybody have any really strong view of what they'd like to do?
I'm kind of limited.
I still like public safety. Unless you want me to switch.
I'm okay with you doing it again unless somebody else has.
No.
Is that okay with you?
No.
Veto.
Wait a minute, I gotta bend down.
If you want me to take Brian's over, I'd be happy to do that.
You want to do public works?
I do.
Okay. John, do you want to stay where you are, or would you like to do something different?
No, I feel I know most of the people in the town hall here, and I hope they're open enough to me to tell me what's going on.
Yeah, I'm just thinking with the visual, what's it called?
Visual gov,
and I think there's going to be a lot of financial stuff right now with the town hall. I'm wondering if it might be better for me to flip over to that.
Do you want to do schools?
Whatever you guys want.
You might have noticed I kind of have a keen interest in the budgeting this year. It's a carryover.
Actually, I think the biggest thing is
a continuation, let's say.
The board docs thing, which we actually, where are we with the board docs?
Bridget had a great idea.
So the visual budget. So we have a kickoff meeting on Friday morning on that project. So.
11.
And then the board doc, I've got a tickler for the special top meeting to raise the money for the board doc.
What is a board doc?
It's a program. It's a program. Like a thing there.
That'll have all this information on here.
Can we tie into our current?
Yeah, they'll come straight to you and you just get it right there.
Okay.
You can watch the baseball game.
It'll eliminate all the paper.
Okay.
And keep it organized. And you can do a quick search.
Yeah.
Great.
There's a big copy paper. The big copy paper box just don't work out very well.
Bridget, I believe we have a demonstration sort of in the works for you. Maybe we could invite Selectman Devine to be part of that.
Sure. She had also said she'd work around other people, so if he wanted to do something on his own, she could work into his schedule.
Demonstration for what?
For the board docs.
Jerry was near it.
So is that okay with you, John?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, I'll stay with the school, I guess.
So John is with
Human Services, Culture, and Recreation.
Right.
Services.
Well, Council on Aging, though, I got conflict with.
I don't think that's really a big conflict.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, he does.
But why is it a conflict if people are just talking to him?
Is it, Wayne, can I take that one as well?
Wait, Wayne, just do Council on Aging at DPW and he does the rest of the...
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Would that be acceptable?
Okay.
Oh, no, and cable TV also.
I'll do cable TV.
Okay.
Either that or you have John do the schools and you pick up the other stuff.
So maybe, no, I think I'll just do cable TV.
All right.
All right, you're in trouble now, Richard.
We can need more baseball. Okay. So then communication. So we had a couple of things that people want to talk about as far as communication. We'll start off where Molly was first. So just general communication for people who don't know. I mean, if you need to contact us, the best thing to do is, if you don't know the person's number or how to contact the individual select board member, it's call Bridget and leave Bridget a message. Because when people want to talk to me, they go to Bridget and Bridget gets me and gives it to me and I call back. Or I'll email them back, however they contact us. So from my standpoint, that works well for me. If you want to call me, that's fine too. But that's the easiest way, because if I'm at work and in a meeting, I won't answer my phone. So if you do call me at work, you just have to let it ring and go to voicemail, then I'll call you back. And then everyone has an email address, which is posted on the website. And then I think everybody knows where we live. Unfortunately. So is there anything else you want to try to do to change that or put some more information out?
There's also the opportunities for the select board to come to the department head meetings. Mm-hmm. I know that that's happened in the past, and people, the department heads, find that enormously helpful to have the select board member there. And finance committee, you're invited as well. First Wednesdays of every month at 11 o'clock in the steering room.
Where?
Right here. We'll be talking about asbestos almost exclusively. in June, but so you might want to skip that one, but otherwise, it's fine.
And then,
is there an agenda for that? Is there a listed agenda for that meeting?
Yes, there'll be an agenda that I'll distribute to the board a few days beforehand.
Please.
Okay, so any other, one thing that Joyce brought up was public comment session before meetings. So let people actually have a time period in front of the meeting, come to the meeting, talk to us. We can do that. The only thing we can't do is discuss and deliberate on what they're saying. So.
But they could be put on a future agenda.
Yes.
Right.
If we felt like that's what we needed to do.
Yes, but we can't.
Which is what we do now.
It is. But then
we don't have a certain time period for anybody. It's going to be
formalizing it.
So it would be like 10, 15 minutes at the beginning of the meeting where people would be invited and they can talk. If no one comes, then we'll do the little bits of businesses we don't have timed.
But the public will still be able to address our agenda articles if there's anything that
yes.
must be stated.
This is anybody wants to come in and address anything, it's, wants to bring up any other thing.
I provided a couple of examples of how it's done in different towns. Some provide a public comment period at the beginning and at the end. Some have only at the beginning, and some have provision for public comment to be allowed at any time, but only by permission of the board.
I personally like leaning towards the first of the meeting, so people who come in and. Because a lot of people I've seen who use this time to use it for advertising an event. Like they come to talk to us about an event that's going on.
Yeah.
Another community's not here. So would you want the beginning or the?
I would say the beginning.
I know that in other towns where they've implemented the public comment period at the beginning of the. Of the meeting, that there's often the concern raised that they don't know what's going to happen in the discussion.
Maybe it should be at the end, so if it does run.
Well, they sort of like it both ways. They want it at the beginning and the end and the middle.
Well, with the school committee, we did it at the beginning of the meeting, and then we could make a decision then and there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it was limited to a certain amount of time. I just don't think. It's like inviting somebody over for dinner and you don't tell them what time dinner is and then they're like hovering about for a while. I mean, it's like our meetings can go to.
I agree.
Yeah.
You know, set it up for the beginning. If you miss the beginning and it needs to be done at the end, then leave allowances.
Yeah.
But then do it at the end.
Yeah.
So we'll formally make one for the beginning of the meeting.
Yep.
So we want to do 10, 15 minutes.
Leave it at 5, and then David can set up scheduling, and then if you need to change it, you can always change it.
Well, in 10-15 minutes, we can almost pull it through all in times.
Oh, I see. I see what you're saying.
No,
and don't
here.
Set up the first appointment until 7:15. Oh, well, that's a fair assumption.
If you say 7:15 is the first appointment, then we can do anything else between the ones here for public comment.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And that way, you don't have a lot of people public comment, and
we can bring the agenda in the old business or whatever and have a period of time like we do in the past.
Yeah, we can. And we're pretty fluid about moving things around. They're untied.
Okay.
All right, so that's it. So is anything else we want to talk about? Our communication?
I think it's great to say, you know, we're available and people can call us and all that, but we need to push information out to the tent. I think, you know, we can do a good job getting more information out to the residents, helping them be more informed before town meetings and the like. I don't see any reason not to. I think a lot of towns do that a little bit, you know, maybe differently than we do. Let's face it, everybody's not at home on Wednesday nights watching what we have to say.
Well, there's a lot that are.
But there are more than one would ever imagine, but yes.
Yes.
And we don't get a lot of print in the paper anymore.
Right.
No.
Okay, so that's limited from what it used to be, I
mm-hmm.
can tell you that.
Yeah.
And a lot of people look to the paper. Citizens, that, you know, there's a lot of citizens out there that aren't very computer savvy.
Mm-hmm.
to get information like that. We used to post the agenda, I mean the warrant articles in the town report and have the town report to everybody or available prior to town meeting. And people used to run to town hall to grab it so that nobody was surprised. You didn't walk into town meeting and grab a warrant article that's 7 pages thick to try to digest it to see what was available. Now we have it available on the internet, and that's good for some people, but it's not good for all people. So what are these ideas as to how to communicate better with the public?
Well, when we get into the outline I had for the planning, I mean, I'm actually interspersing public forums. You know, one of the first things I think we need to do in the strategic planning process is, you know, your standard SWOT analysis. I mean, having each functional area take a look at what we do well, you know, the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats exercise, but it's a very valid one. And then communicate the results of that out to people. Let them know, look at this is where we think we're struggling. This is where we're doing a great job on our reserves and why our, you know, Standard & Poor's rating went up, but that doesn't mean that there aren't some issues over here. And it, you know, you don't have to go to that sort of a session having all the answers either. I think it it really engages the public in the dialogue. And I know, you know, there's some people that will say, oh, well, we know we have forums and nobody shows up and all of that.
Yeah,
people have to get used to something, though. You know, they have to get used to it.
I didn't know, I had listed here where the public's forum's going to be at the selectmen's meetings or subsequent to them.
Well, actually, when you start thinking about public forums, you start thinking about meeting space, and this is all the space we have for a public forum. We do it here.
Right.
We have to think about moving someplace else.
Yeah. You know, whether it's the current senior center or something like that. But I mean, that's one idea. I think we can continue to look at our website and other ways to utilize that. I think that's come a long way, you know, in the past couple of years, again, putting a lot more information out there.
I think the VizGov and the board docs, once we get that going, that's going to be a big communication for people, because it'll be there, and you'll be able to look it up and see it. I mean, that's our biggest request is for stuff that was in the packet several months ago,
we still, you know, Richard's still got two, have you hired your assistant yet? Haven't got anybody to help you? We still got two channels that we really need to utilize, and a lot of that information can be put online.
So,
have we requested email accounts from everybody via the water bills or anything like that for pertinent information or for putting out warrants?
There is a way to sign up for community information through the town website. If you go to www.hadleyma.org, you'll find an email sign up button on the left-hand side of the screen. So we distribute information such as the warrant by email or notices or alerts or anything other. And this is where the issue that comes before the board.
Do you know I've signed up for that three times?
Have you really?
I've signed up for it three times and I have never gotten a communication. And I've looked in my junk mail and everything else, and I'm, you know, pretty adept at signing up for a, you know, service like that. It's not hard. And so,
why don't you come in? We'll work with you on that.
Yeah. I mean, but, you know, so I think, you know, you can be a little bit at the mercy of, you know, your spam filtering and stuff like that, too, with that kind of thing. But that's definitely a worthwhile thing.
I think we should announce it on town meeting floor, because town meeting floor, you'll find 112 people that are at every town meeting. You'll find other people that are there for specific issues that are hot buttons for them, but at least those people that are diehard town meeting people would have the availability to get that, and they would feel less, we'd get a little less deer in the headlights kind of look as to, boy, I really can't answer and get all the information I need on this topic tonight. I'm going to have to think about this. Can we put it off till fall? So I think that would help. And then I think if we also did it via the, like I said, the tax bill or the water bill or something like that, mm-hmm. I think if we provide people with the means, and let's by all means, please fix it before we send this out and people don't get information back to us. Let's send them a nice letter, you know, zing it back immediately. Thanks for signing up. You know, if you have any questions, please call us at this number. But, you know, at this point in time, you're signed up and this is what you'll be receiving.
You know, and in future planning, we're paying for these ballots for overrides for our questions. That we should have 5 or 6 non-binding questions on every single one of those so we can have a general idea of the direction that we need to go from the public.
We certainly can do that, and I know that the planning board is currently undergoing the process of updating the long-range plan as well.
Yeah. But,
and we should make sure somebody gets to them as well and says, geez, these are a couple of the hot buttons that we have. Can we make sure it goes out on your informational?
I mean, I can make a decision yes or no, but with 5,000 people in this town, I would really like to know what the general consensus is of the people of the town, the taxpayers, before I make a conscious decision of the direction we should be going.
On some of these decisions, you can't wait for the general opinion of 5,000 people.
I understand.
And that's the reason that you
were
elected, was to make some of these decisions in a conscious, with other, your members of your board. That's why you're elected. You know, they put trust in you that you're going to make some good decisions. We're not going to make all decisions without informed information.
No, but I think John's point is the more input you have,
you're not going to get 5,000
residents to respond.
No, but even
if it's 500 people, it's a number to look at and say, look, these 500 people want us to look into this issue in this way, you know?
Yeah. I think the biggest time we had any response is when we built the new elementary school. And they had to choose the model that they wanted.
Yeah, there was 3 choices on that.
There was 3 choices on that. We mailed it to every household.
We got a fabulous response to the long-range plan.
Mm-hmm.
Fabulous.
Yeah. The library survey, they did an excellent job on that when it came through. You know, the people want to have a little bit of say here too, you know?
So then if we think about maybe doing a few more surveys, that might be the way to go about it. But again,
I thought we were going to do a survey. I thought that Linda Dunleavy was going to get us that. That was spoken about last year at one of our tri-board meetings, and we haven't received that information yet.
No, she was going to try to get the one from Franklin County.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That would be a start for us.
That was for what?
I think we're going to, I was thinking, you know, maybe we need to do more surveys like that. Library, where we ask people what they expect, we start talking about what services people want, that would be the time to do a survey and send it out and give people a feedback, give us a feedback.
Isn't that
what
that entailed?
Yeah.
Services.
She was going to give you the actual the wage that they had. And
we're talking 2 different things.
We're talking about information from the people in town. It was a survey from them.
Yeah, this was like a couple of years ago.
Yes, that one. Yeah.
But the other thing too, and part of my point about the public forums or even it, you know, we can utilize HPAD as well, just to put even like PowerPoint slides that repeat or whatever, but and you know the VisGov. But you want to contextualize the questions. Right?
You do.
So if you say, you know, rank 1 to 10 all of these services, and somebody's doing it thinking, wow, look at all this, we've got money to pay for all of this. Or are you doing it in the context of, we can't keep doing all of this, you know, unless we find a new revenue source. So it changes the, you know, answers a bit. So that's why I think attacking it from multiple fronts is worthwhile.
So.
And we can keep talking about this.
Yes,
I just
we can.
Wanted to raise the.
We've been talking for a while now. Do we want to try to wrap up another 5 minutes and then decide which ones we're going to keep talking about next meeting?
What we had talked about last time was that we would have a discussion here and then at the tri-board meeting, which I think is June 10th.
It's not the third
because Linda
graduation.
Yeah, it's graduation week.
Oh, that's
week.
Right. That's
following
right.
Following week.
All right.
Yeah, so I think we decided to move tri-board to the 10th. So, I mean, I was hoping that, just from my standpoint, if you guys could look over this calendar just in the general conceptual way, and so that if we're going into the tri-board meeting, we're, you know, we've kind of vetted it a bit before we engage the other two committees in discussion, because I'm sure they'll have suggestions too.
Well, actually, before we do, so then talking about the calendar, we've kind of tossed around this capital thing a bit, and then where we want to stick capital. It was an annual town meeting, and we said, well, why don't we do capital and have capital come in at a fall town meeting? Do we want to take a position that we really want it to come in at a fall town meeting, or we want to let it come wherever it fits in the schedule we give?
I was going to issue the capital budget request at the end of this month, with the due date, I believe, beginning of August.
Yeah, and I put in August, during the month of August, that the capital plan would be a focal point of discussion.
So we want to stick with doing, making capital plan come up in fall town meeting, and at least gear this one towards it.
Absolutely. You have your final numbers then. You're not guessing. You're not trying to figure it out. You have your numbers available to you. Your free cash has been certified. If you're going to use that, you know already. I think it's
so
a wonderful idea.
That.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. So now we're not being wishy-washy anymore. We've decided.
Yep.
Excellent.
And we'll look this over for the 10th.
Yes, that means we meet on the 3rd.
I think that'll relieve a little pressure on the annual budget and preparation for it, too.
Actually, it doesn't, and that's one of the comments I had. I was going to make this evening, or to Molly, you know, by email. One of the problems with just doing capital in the fall without looking at the budget coming up is that, again, you're doing things piecemeal. So you spend $500,000 on capital items, and it's, we all know we need the capital items, and we're not spending it recklessly. But it, that puts us with pressure for the next
annual meeting,
right, and the budget. And especially this year and the following couple of years, David's own numbers are projecting possible budget deficits. So without looking at it, without looking at the FY17 budget, you don't know how much to save. So you're reviewing the FY15 budget that you're closing out, seeing how that relates to the FY16 budget that you're a couple months into, but you've got to have some rough numbers on FY17 before you start spending free cash that we may be needing to balance the operational budget.
Well, and I had that all in the month of August, and that's why I said it might be a little bit too condensed, but the detailed discussion of free cash for FY16 and the impact on future years, that's happening in concert with the discussion about the capital plan. So, I mean, I think at some point we need to go back to having a multi-year schedule of capital. So, again, just my thought was that if we could focus on that in August this year, and then that becomes the living, breathing capital planning document that we're working with, to your point. But we're doing it in the context of revenue projections. Yeah.
And budget projections.
And budget projections. So I totally agree with you. I think it's just a question of what form it's taking.
Yeah.
We've identified for the capital budget purposes, is it the meals tax or is it the hotel tax?
No. We need to kind of talk about that. We kind of need to make a decision on what we do a percentage, because every time we say meals tax, the meals tax changes. So that, does that mean we spend more, or do we spend, the meals tax goes down, we spend less? We've been talking about setting a percentage of the budget and said that, you know, that's what we're going
to
shoot for.
Didn't it used to be 250? Hadn't we set it at 250?
Yeah, but
it was
the
capital. Started at 240 when it first started, and then it's up to 300,000.
300,000 now.
So even if you kept it at 250,
but
and kept that number, I mean, then you'd still have
planning
and capital money over the 250 that you would put somewhere else.
I'd rather see it start here.
And if you look up at a percentage, it would probably be more in a certain year.
I kind of like the number because those are the things that we always put off and don't do. And we've always used capital since this has been available to us.
Right.
You know, this is the only way that we've been able to afford to do any of our capital expenditures.
Our starting point, Joyce, could be your number, whatever percentage that is of the relative budget. But for exactly the reason you just stated, I think you want it to be a percentage because if you stick with a fixed number, you've got inflationary pressures and you've got all sorts of things. So your budget's going like this, but the tendency is going to be to stick with the 250 for the sake of argument.
Okay.
So this way you're actually kind of keeping up with. You can always spend less, right?
Yeah, I just didn't want to.
Yeah, you don't want to go the other way.
I just wanted to at least stay that way, and then if you had more, it could stay for some other purpose.
How was our plan set up with this, with replacement of vehicles, with replacement capital planning? How was it set up? Was it set up on an annual number?
Needs.
Needs, and it just wasn't vehicles.
Okay, where are we on our needs base now? At this point in time, are we keeping up with it? Are we ahead of schedule? Or are we way behind?
I'm keeping up.
See, and that's to your point, that capital plan, we haven't really looked at it since I've been on the select. So the capital planning committee has gone off, but it's never really kind of been integrated back into our discussion as a select board.
As part of
the whole.
They've kept track of it.
Yes. Finance has, though.
And actually, they've garnered in, now wanting to take what comes from school.
Well, what's happened is they kind of tell us that the process has been so. It's taken so long that we don't get the capital stuff until the end. So we're all wrapping everything up and they're coming in with, ooh.
Yeah.
So, yes.
At spring town meeting.
Yeah.
But at fall town meeting.
So right as we talk about laying everything out and trying to get everything in order, that's what we need to do is make sure that comes out a little sooner, we get it all, and you know, what's going on.
And if we're looking at borrowing down the road, and David's doing a projection, that needs to be built into debt notice.
Borrowing for capital needs to be in the capital number. That's the percentage we're spending. I mean, that truly is the percentage we're spending on capital, is that borrowing and principal and interest.
Mm-hmm.
So that needs to be there too, so we see our full picture. We're not just borrowing, we're not just borrowing this, because we could be borrowing something for something else. I mean, so, David?
You covered everything I was going to say.
Excellent.
Good job.
But then I think there is something we've forgotten to do. Just quickly, is have we appointed who's going to be on the capital committee for the select board since Brian left?
I was appointed to it. I thought we were.
Second.
We're going to leave you there then.
Something I maybe can do.
Yes. Is that okay?
Yeah, totally.
All right. So.
All right.
Congratulations. We did that when he wasn't here one night.
We did.
I know, and I went to the last couple meetings before.
So I think we're all set with that. So then our homework again is to go over the Molly's conceptual.
I don't think we answered Howard's question. Howard's telling us that going to the fall town meeting may not be the best
option. I think we did.
No, it is the best option for capital,
okay.
Because you do know the numbers.
Yeah.
You know, delaying it for the spring doesn't help. You know, you'll know them in August when the books finally close for FY15.
Well, you're just looking at the number that we spend to affect the
next
year's
budget. But at that
point,
it's that number to see, are you going to spend that percentage for capital, or are there competing needs to keep departments in the town afloat?
So you actually would have an option one way or the other. If we have the capital plan prepared for you in August or early September at the latest, you still have the option if you wanted to defer it to the springtown meeting.
Absolutely.
You can, because those numbers aren't going to change, really. You know, capital tends to be pretty stable so long as people put into the capital plan what they truly need. And that has been a challenge for some departments. They don't put things in, and then they come and bring stuff out at the last minute.
It's always easier to put it in and then say, well, you know, I really need this more than this.
Yeah, yeah.
So I guess we need to talk to the department heads and make sure they know.
Yeah.
And put it in and plan out your whole, and give us a 5-6 year plan, and then when you're in the meeting, say, this is more important than this. And mm-hmm. That's much easier.
The other thing I wanted to comment on your calendar, mm-hmm. when you get into January and the budget coming and mm-hmm. How to get to the spring town or the annual town meeting, we ran into a snag this year, and it caused some concern at the end. I got an awful lot of calls from department heads that weren't happy with the process, mm-hmm. We as a finance committee were happy that we could sit down with the select board and department heads and go through that process that we went through, rather than you guys meeting with department heads. We meet with them, you know, 2 weeks later, bounce it back and forth. It stops that whip-sawing of our both boards back and forth. But we need to move that schedule up about a month and a half, so that when we get to April, we've got at least a pretty good picture of where we are with budgets.
Yes.
We can get back to the department heads like we've done in the past. I've always notified department heads and say, look, this is where the finance committee is, you know, within a few bucks right now. These are the issues that we have remaining. Notify the department heads, give them a chance to come back and, you know, talk about their budgets. And then when we give them the final number, we're not doing it, you know, a few days before a town meeting. They haven't had a chance to come back and discuss things, and there was a lot of
hurt feelings.
Yes.
So Howard, yeah. In the month of April right now, I've got discussion of any recommended finance committee changes to the budget, communication of suggested changes to department heads for discussion if it has not already occurred, a public hearing on the budget.
So that should probably be
March. That should be the
budget.
Last. Yeah.
Yeah, and then after the public hearing is when the budget's finalized for fall for annual town meeting. And you wouldn't.
When'd your cherry sheet come out?
Right. It depends. This year it came out at the end of February. Usually it comes out end of January.
So do you want to move a couple of those up to March?
Well, what I wanted to do was that in January.
Yeah.
Get the budget so that the town administrator is giving the budget not just to the select board but yep. to the finance committee, that's set as of mid-January or something like that. We both can start our
hearing.
Process after that while we're looking at an overall number and seeing how different things fit into it, and then you're starting to talk to department heads. We're available for those meetings with the department heads, but it also allows us to start crunching numbers on other items.
Correct.
Well, that's the way that this is set up. So if you just want to take another look at it and see if you want those bullets moved, because I have the budget.
It isn't that the topics aren't there. That's what I was saying earlier. I just want to move up about a month and a half.
So one thing we probably need to make more clear to the department heads during the budget process is the department heads submit their input to the town administrator. The town administrator takes that and makes a budget out of it, and
right.
the town administrator submits a budget. So it doesn't necessarily have to be the department head's budget.
Well,
and there needs to be discussion between the department head and the town administrator
exactly.
at that point. And I know there was some and then there wasn't some. So
right.
that's the part where there's the talk there that says, this is what I'm recommending, this is why I'm recommending it. And the department head and the town administrator can sit behind in their office and slug it out and decide yes, no, yes, no,
and
then we get to our budget.
That's the second bullet in January.
Yes, and then the town administrator gives us his budget, which he's required to by our rules,
mm-hmm.
in January,
yep.
and then we start. And then the other thing we need to do is we need to hold, once we set that budget, we don't react to every change in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
We need to stop doing that.
Yep.
Unless it's like Armageddon, we don't need to change just because the governor says this, the House says this. We stay with our numbers until we get closer and closer.
And it's still changing to this day.
It's still changing.
Still
changing. And it'll change through July or August.
I need to tell you, I called Howard today and I said, I'm going to advocate for pushing town meeting back a month. He says it doesn't matter, a tinker's dam. It still isn't going
to
be finalized if you move it back a month.
And
leave it where it is, everybody's used to it.
Yeah.
No.
having everybody go, what's going on?
Well, I talked to another department in another community, and he says, yeah, damn budget season started. I said, really? Mine's all done.
But going back to your point, there's an issue whether the department heads can show the budget that they want, you know, in a call. And then when they make that conversation with David and they come to their agreement, then you've got that next call.
Right.
So that you can see, you know, what's going on. Is there something here that we should be concerned about, or isn't there?
And that's the way the budget actually is laid out. But I think
we had some real issues this year, because
we were saying some things like don't do this, and some people we said don't put your 2 COLA in there. We'll take care of the COLAs later. Just show us what your step raises are. I think there was some confusion in the directions that were given by us that threw those numbers off a little bit, and they didn't understand. Plus, we had a couple department heads that this was their first go at this. Next year, we'll only have one department head that'll be their first time at this, hopefully. Yeah, hopefully. So I think that was just a miscommunication. We just need to make that communication better. Because, yeah, they were both there. But then again, the department head's recommendation wasn't always what he thought he had put in.
However.
Yeah.
All right. Moving on.
Okay. So for our next meeting, we'll continue the discussion with the schedule.
No, we can't stop this until we thank Molly for doing such a great job of putting this together. I really appreciate it, and I spent a lot of time on it today, and not one-tenth of what I'm sure you spent on it. Thank you.
You're very welcome, Jerry.
Did you do it while you were driving?
While I was driving?
Yeah.
No. I was actually seated at a desk.
Okay. All right, so.
Downtime.
And then we do have a lot of catching up to do with town business, normal business for the next meeting too. But so we have our meeting on the 3rd to do this, and then we'll have the tribal meeting on the 10th.
We've addressed taking care of town employees. I think we also got to reach out to the rest of the elected officials and the other department heads, mm-hmm. and get to them. Let's get the Historical Society, let's get the library, although there's a lot of communication with the library, let's get the planning board, let's get everybody else involved, and let's do something to build a little better relationship here. We've had kind of a tough year. So a lot of things went wrong this year that got kind of, you know, people have sore toes over. Let's work on, here you got a plan to work towards something to get it going in the right direction. Let's communicate with everybody. The planning board, a lot of what we talked about tonight is under the planning board's purview, you know, as far as what the
zoning and
things like that too. What's that?
We got that email this afternoon. They just invited us to their meeting to talk
June
about 16th, the roads.
Which is probably one of our meetings.
It's a Tuesday. So to your point though,
Tuesday.
I mean, I think their people are trying to.
Yes, and we have an item coming up where we're going to probably have to bring the planning board and the conservation commission and us together to talk about if we want to do something or not. So,
cultural council, CPA,
CPA for sure. Yeah.
Let's reach out to these people.
The last CPA meeting, we discussed trying to get with the select board so that we can get through, and the new chair, Edwin, is working on a letter that you'll probably receive in the next week or so.
Okay, good.
Trying to say what we can do and what we can't do, and trying to improve the process of projects coming forward so that people, not just the town department heads and whatever, but the general public can see what's involved in the application from the time you request and what's eligible and the process that it has to go through. So hopefully that'll be some value so that we can utilize CPA funds for projects.
Okay.
All right.
Good.
Good.
All right.
One last thing. In your list of 4 pages that you went through, you mentioned the wage study.
In June.
I wait in breathless anticipation. We were put in a position this year that I don't like being put in. It's not our job to set wages for town employees.
Or policy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
Yeah, and so just the last we left off on that, you were talking about the university?
Yep, we got our partnership agreement signed so we can tap into that resource to help them.
Now, well, given the fact that we're going into the summer and it's not going to be part of the academic year, is that going to preclude us from being able to utilize resources?
I don't think so.
Will there be grad students?
Yeah.
All right, any announcements?
We have a parade coming up.
Oh, yeah. Sunday.
Oh, my God. Sunday.
Sunday is the parade.
Those marching. Finance
Good
committee,
night.
Come join us in marching.
I'll be on the golf course.
Thank you.
That's how this meeting started. Enjoy the parade.
Thanks for your input.
All of our
Thank you.
Elected officials and our appointed committees, anybody that would like to participate in the parade, please come and join us. The select board and school committee, or whoever else, we usually go to the cemeteries prior to the march on Route 9 at 2 p.m. If you're going to go to the cemeteries, we meet at the Legion at 10:45.
And if you want a repeat of the Hopkins Band performance in the
yeah.
parade, you can go Monday to the Amherst Parade and see the Hopkins Band there. So
mm-hmm.
it's a twofer.
It is. There you go. And I also would like to send condolences to Philip McCreskey's family on his passing. We're sincerely sorry.
Any other announcements?
Motion adjourned. Oh, sorry, oh. sorry.
I dropped something off April 27th for declaring the sewer division to pick up that surplus equipment. And to list it on the NISA bid, so I'm just asking the board's permission to do that. I guess this letter was downstairs for a while. And the reason is that John, that's John's pickup, he's got the new pickup now, so he doesn't need that anymore. And we'd like to declare it a surplus, put it on the NISA bid, and to get rid of it.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Abstain.
Mm-hmm. Any other announcements?
See you at the parade.
Mm-hmm.
Motion adjourned.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good night, everybody.